Welcome to another edition of the Adam Dunn Show. I am your host, Adam Dunn.
And I'm your co-host, Mitch Shinasa.
And we are here at Sohai Gallery.
Outside Sohai Gallery.
Outside, because we're getting ready for the show tonight.
Yes, we are.
We have a pogo show going on tonight, so if you're in town, come down and check us out.
Yeah, I think we did. No, at least one listener is going to be in town, so hopefully they'll roll through.
I hope more than one listener is in town.
Okay. Well,
I hope there's more than one actual listener.
I mean someone who's not from, from here.
Oh, I see what you mean now. Yeah, we know our friends will be down here, right?
Yep.
Sure. Last time, though, we showed up.
Remember that? There were tons of people last
time. But it was all different people.
Yeah, that's true.
We have a totally unique show.
Well, people are asking if we're on mute, so I think we're going to be unique in the regard that they can't hear us.
They can't hear us?
I'm on it.
All right.
1, 2, 3, 4, 7, 8. No, we look good on here. I might bring up the master a little.
Check it out.
All right, maybe we're a little louder now. Maybe they had their speakers set up. Okay, sound up, says Buck.
Sound up, good.
Sounding up. Sorry.
If there's one person we can count
sounding
on,
up.
It's Buck.
Buck is there.
He will tell us what the fuck is going on.
Yeah. Okay, hopefully people can hear us now.
So we have in-studio guests today. We've got Miss Diane Fornbacher here.
Of Ladybud.
Ladybud magazine and online. I think they're online now, right? Well, we'll find out.
Not for us to know.
Exactly. And then later on, we have...
Is Kayvon coming?
Kayvon is coming.
He's a big deal. It's important.
Yeah, and we're going to talk about social use with Kayvon and with Diane and also about just the direction that this fucking place is going in, you know?
Yeah, I was talking about it earlier with Rob at lunch where it's like, it's one thing when you like read about reading a history book and you see, oh, in 1465 this happened, in 1467 that happened, in 1469 that happened, and... Like, those 2 years don't seem to make a big difference, and the 4 years don't seem to make a big difference. But when you're living in history and the shit's happening in real time, the amount of difference 2 years makes is insane. Kayvon's in the building, obviously. Going to chill in our soon-to-be green room, our outdoor green room, couch.
Exactly, waiting, you know, waiting.
Yeah, it's good.
It's good, I like that.
So, yeah, being here, living in history, kind of major to and important to be looking ahead and back and...
It's also important that we don't get screwed over. And that's what's happening right now, it seems like.
Is that what's going to happen?
Well, not yet. I mean, hopefully not. Hopefully with the right direction, we're not going to. But at this point in time, yes, we are being screwed over.
Well, that's true. We are still being screwed over, I guess.
Oh, yeah. I mean, to the point where, like, I just realized the other day about this whole fucking plant count shit.
Oh, yeah. So well, how did that end up? Did you get your plant count?
I talked to Warren about it. And apparently what's happened is there's four doctors that got in trouble. Yeah. And they got screwed pretty hard. And so basically all the...
Like in jail? Or
no,
can't be doctors anymore.
Probably
sure.
Lost their fucking practicing license. Sure. So basically that set precedent with all the other guys who now are all flipping out.
All the other doctors are scared.
Yeah. So anybody who gave extended plant counts is apparently being investigated. And
retroactively.
And not the people who did it. Like, so if you went in and got your extended plant count, you're not being investigated.
Right, the doctor.
But the doctor is to make sure that he did the right thing to prescribe you that or to recommend higher plant counts. So it's basically there's a couple of places left in Colorado that are still just doing it and saying, whatever, let's go for it. And one down in the Springs, Medival or something like that.
Okay, Medival. Yeah,
Medival, yeah. They're still doing it. But most of the doctors apparently are only going for 35. That's it. Like they won't go anymore.
Max.
35 max. Because they're saying anything over 70,
yeah,
you'll be investigated. So
they're going half of that.
Exactly. So they're just trying to play it safe. So I feel like, if you really are medically needing cannabis in the first place, and you have a great, you know, you have a big gigantic file full of all of the times you've been to the doctor, and you're fine, and you can go. And
I don't know if you would call it a great file.
Well, it's not a great file. It's a bad file to have.
Very bad,
right now, it's the file you want to have, unfortunately. But, like, if you're trying to get extended plant count and you're just trying to do it for the sake of doing it, I wouldn't even recommend going in and trying to do it because you're just setting yourself up at that point.
I'm just going to say no. They're not going to call the cops on you.
No, but you're probably going to get denied. So,
well,
but I think it's going to change. I think
it's funny how, like, we were talking about it the other day. I don't know if Kyle got it in the news, but, like, they're passing these new laws on what lights you're allowed to grow with.
And that doesn't seem like possible. Like they have the jurisdiction.
15 years ago, people didn't care what the laws were. They just grew pot. It was all illegal.
Sure.
Now people actually care. Oh my God, I got to change my lights. Like,
yeah.
All of a sudden, you're concerned about growing pot legally. It's a weird game at work.
Well, it proves, in my opinion, that it's actually like we all really want this to work. You know what I mean? Otherwise, we'd all just be going. Yeah, we'd all be going. Oh, good. I'm growing 1,000 plants. It's like no. Plant count's important, you know what I mean? And you just have to adapt and change the way we grow is really what it's going to come down to.
Well, yes. So you think everyone in Colorado is going to grow 30 trees outside now? That's the new Colorado.
Probably plant. More likely than not, or just big greenhouse. You know, get a greenhouse and 35 plants, and that's
trees though.
Trees, exactly. That's the way I would do it.
That's what you got to do. That's what they did in Oregon.
That's what they did in Cali. I mean, Cali was 99 forever. Now people just don't seem to give a shit. They're growing 500 and 600. Yeah.
Five cards or whatever.
Right, right. But up until a point, it was like 99 limit, and that seemed like amazing and unbelievable, you know? So I think we just got to, I think the whole point is that we get used to certain things real quick, you know? It doesn't take long for us to get used to
a
new, yeah, and we're all like, okay. So it kind of, I don't know, I don't know if that's a good thing or a bad thing, because it also shows that we could easily be diverted off the path pretty fast.
Bit by bit, just like little incremental.
Right.
And then next thing you know, you turn around and you're like, holy shit, you can only smoke this stuff Sunday.
Yeah.
In a scheduled van.
In a vape pen. Yeah. Only from this company. Not those company vape pens, because those ones actually work.
In this zone of the city, and you got a pen.
Right. So, well, let's hope that's not the future. But it is strange to see all of our sort of, you know, comrades, as you would say, all the people that grew weed for so long illegally, and now just being so quick to jump over and then follow every rule possible.
And not only that, but to like throw everyone else under the bus.
Yeah.
And you're finding yourself. That's what's scary about it. Because I find myself being like, oh, well, they deserved it. They were, you see those guys, you see how they were blowing that place up? How could they not deserve it? Like,
right.
Well, who the fuck am I?
Right. And, that's society changing slowly. And at the end of the day, if you, look at the gray area of cannabis, I feel like it's tiny here compared to like California and other places that are just hog wild. I go out there and I'm like, people are still selling 100 packs? Like, this is crazy. I mean, I don't even hear about it here. Like, here it's almost
you can find the little things.
I'm sure if you go out and search, you get anywhere you can find it, but
yeah,
still,
but
you'd think
it'd be like falling in your lap where people, hey,
yeah, I got this. That doesn't happen.
You know
here.
Anyone looking for it? Yeah.
No, very rarely do I ever hear that. Right. Very rarely.
And it's almost seemed like.
And it's like when I hear it, I go like, no. Like,
yeah,
no.
Yeah, exactly. And it's funny, too, because it's that same thing where, like, you know, back in the day, before you moved here, 15 years ago, 20 years ago, you had your guy, and he was your pot guy, but he could get you everything.
Yeah.
And mushrooms and everything else. I don't know where to get other drugs now.
Right. Right. Yeah, you're not going to go out, like, dabbling around the street looking for people.
Or, you know, the guys I call for weed now only have weed. They got 10 kinds of the best weed in the world.
Yeah.
But that's it.
Right. Yeah. No, that is what they should have been thinking about a long time ago, because isn't that how you would have separated? Wouldn't that be the way to stop all these things? You're like, hey, look, it's not a one-stop shop anymore. You can actually go to buy your real deal. And so it's...
I don't believe in the gateway drug, but I believe in the gateway dealer, 100%.
100%, yes. That is what the gateway is right there.
Yeah,
it's the person, it's not the drug.
Like, nah, actually, dude, I'm a little light on herb, but you try one of these before?
Sure.
That happens.
It's funny, I was listening yesterday also on some, it was like some cheesy thing on Facebook, but it literally was like an old school dealer trying to hustle somebody, right? And it was really funny to listen to. And he was like, oh man, I got you. You're going to be feeling, you'll be on cloud nine. You know, like all these little things he was trying to impress this person with whatever he was trying to sell him. And it was just pretty funny. I was like, yep, those were the days.
Remember that?
Remember.
Yeah. So.
How was your week?
My week was good.
Good.
Oh, wait. So it sounds like we're having mic problems.
Are we?
That's what it's looking like.
From everybody or just one guy?
The whole chat room agrees.
Really?
The whole chat room agrees.
What do we got to do? Levels are too low?
It all looks good to me, but I don't really know what I'm looking at. But here's what we'll do. We'll pull this up, pull it up, and maybe I'll switch mics. KTI, let me see that mic, buddy. Okay, this one sounds better to me. Hopefully it sounds better to the chat room.
All right, check all the levels.
I don't know what we're looking at here. Everyone changes everything. Kid sets it up. Vinny sets it up. Now, this is definitely much louder. I can see that automatically. That's happening on the levels here. So, now people are saying my mic was good. Sounds a bit better. I don't know. Guys, okay, I do sound good now. Thanks, Spring Hill. Everybody.
I sound shitty.
No, KTI is going to sound shit.
Yeah.
That's fine.
No, he sounds fine. I don't know.
Yeah, I can't tell.
Weird acoustics.
We need to upgrade.
All right, so.
So you're sad. You had a sad week.
A sad week? No, a good week. Why'd I have a sad week?
You sounded sad.
No, I had a good week.
Sad sound in your voice.
No, I feel great. I feel like we sound fine. Don't change anything. Someone else is now texting me. Okay, good. Okay, so we know. People do this to us to fuck with us, I think. I think they're just trolling us, being like, oh, it's your mic. It's your mic. Yeah.
They like to watch us switch mics.
Uh-huh. They think it's funny. It's not funny.
So, yes, your week was great.
Your week was great, yeah.
Oh, I got to go down to the farm last week. That was kind of cool.
Which farm? Oh, the farm the where farm, we have your stuff. Yeah.
That was pretty fun to see.
Yeah.
Oh,
wasn't it good how I told you that they all look terrible? So when you went down there and they look great, you were like, oh, no, these look great.
Exactly. Well, there was some terrible zones, though.
But if I told you it looked amazing and you went down there, you'd be like, hey, you should have looked amazing, and then you'd only see the problems.
Right. True. Thanks for that.
Yeah,
thanks
for managing expectations, that's called.
Good job.
But
see, I got to do that. That was fun. Wife and kids still out of town.
What? This is a long one.
I know. 3 weeks.
So you're going completely rogue, huh?
I'm gone rogue, yeah, completely.
How many nights have you stayed up too late watching movies and eating candy?
Passed out every night, pretty much.
On
5 o'clock in the morning. I wake up on the couch pretty much at 5:28 every night and go, or every morning and go, like, what the hell is going on?
Do you watch anything good?
Nah, like conspiracy style. I watch anything like I can't watch when Cece's around.
Yeah, yeah, of
like,
course.
Oh, Cece's not around. I'll watch,
she hates the shit. I'll
watch some Nazi conspiracy crap or something. You know, just weird shit. But
yeah.
I went through the some 9/11 stuff as usual. I can't help it, dude.
Dude, well, so did you see that thing
that I posted
that I sent you? There's a guy in Thailand.
Oh, yeah, that's awesome.
Who's trying to raise money to redo 9/11 to prove the conspiracy. That's not awesome.
Is it?
No.
Is he going to fly a plane into a building? No.
They're going to build a fucking... They're going to build the World Trade Center just to knock it down. That's not a good idea.
They're not doing
that
for real.
That's what he's trying to do.
Life-sized?
Yes, he's trying to prove it.
That doesn't make sense.
It's ridiculous. I know.
I thought you meant, like, models.
No, you can't prove it with a model. No, he's trying to raise it. Well, just like, that's awesome. That's
okay. And it's going to burn and burn and burn and never fall down. That's what we're...
Well, he's trying to prove...
That it can't fall down.
Right.
Oh, that's what I was watching. It was 9/11 coincidences last night. That was pretty good.
There's something called 9/11 coincidences?
Yeah, and it was all like, suspicious. it was all like, damn, that is pretty coincidental. You know
like
I mean?
That they were doing the air raid drill,
all that
shit?
Yeah, all the classic stuff. But and then the fact that the three buildings, that only three buildings in history that ever collapsed were the same, those three buildings on that day. There's never, ever been
another vertical collapse.
Never, ever, which is, you know, so whatever. Whatever.
There's that. Whatever, there's things. We could do a 9/11 episode. It's coming up.
I know it is. I won't be here, though.
Really?
I'll be on a fishing boat.
What? Oh, what? How long are you? Because I'm going to be gone for September 14th.
I think I'm back on that day.
Oh, good. Because that's
the Han Solo show?
Or for September 16th or whatever.
Is that the show date?
16th is the show.
Oh, I'll be back.
Yeah.
I'll wing it.
So you have a solo show with two. Let's go through the coming shows. This is actually a good.
Oh,
good
we announce it. We're announcing.
Yes, because want to know it's what? Official? There's only 26 people in the chat room right now, but yeah. They're like the diehards.
Okay,
and they need to know.
26 will tell everybody what's going on.
You guys, I hope you're fucking listening because spread the word. This Wednesday, we're actually doing a Wednesday evening live show, and I'm gonna get the date for you because it's pretty mega. It's going to be Wednesday, the 31st of August.
Whoa, what a crazy
day. What a great day, right?
31st
of August, yeah.
Yep.
This Wednesday.
Drum roll.
The day after Mercury goes into retrograde.
Oh, their day is going to suck.
He goes, oh.
Their day is going to
settle
suck.
Down. We will have the, I don't know if it's president, CEO of the Hawthorne Group. This is the division of Scott's that has purchased Botanicare, Gavita, more acquisitions to come.
General Hydro.
Is that a public?
Yes. Oh, yeah.
General Hydro.
They did it, yeah.
You've been reading news articles about it. It's all over the place. We're going to have them in studio with us here.
Live.
So we are going to take questions from you guys, but we're not just going to take Skype questions because that gets unwieldy. You can, on the website, on the Facebook, you're going to be able to go enter your questions. We'll cull through them, and then we'll be asking at the live event, but we'll have them here to answer all your questions, tell us all about it. I mean, I don't even want to get too into it right now, but my first thing, the number one question I have is, what do you know as fucking whatever billionaire Scott's guy that tells you that now's a good time to invest in this? Do you know that it's going to be legalized next year? Do you know that something big is going to change? Because right now, it's a pretty small market unless you know that something's going to change. So what do you know,
and it's
right?
Exactly what I heard from... when I was talking to Jamin Shively, the Microsoft guy,
he was
basically said the same thing. He was, you know, pulled aside and told this is going to happen in the next 3 years. And it did, as far as like Seattle, where he was right. located and everything. So he got the tap on the shoulder, which is basically what everybody's going to get. And that's the thing that people, you know, if you're above a certain level, you're getting that tap. Yeah. You know what I mean? You're going to, hey, you know what? You might want to diversify. And you might want
I don't know if it's as official as like someone sends like a fucking raven to you with a message.
I
think it's like you're at a party and being like, hey, you see this weed thing? Looking crazy. I'm thinking of investing in that.
Sure.
And then he goes, oh, yeah, yeah, I talked to my buddy, Joe, who's down at, just like when we were with, you know, those guys who mm-hmm. talk all like that.
Yep.
Yep. So, exactly. I was talking to my buddy Joe, and his cousin is the mayor, and he was the judge, and it's definitely happening in April. And, like, that's how it happens.
That's exactly how it happens.
So...
Ooh,
so we'll find out.
So
we'll find out who's judgy cousin.
Exciting.
They know.
That's
you can tell Adam's like jumping out of his seat. He can't wait.
No, it's gonna be great. We might get Yair on the phone. We might.
Hopefully, we'll have Yair from Gavita calling in. We'll definitely have Doug from Botanicare here. The CEO of Botanicare, unfortunately, is at Burning Man. I don't know why that's
all
predictable
the CEOs,
to me.
All
yeah,
the
most
CEOs
are at Burning Man. Yeah, we will have the Hawthorne Group guy here, which is pretty fucking cool. And we'll have a big discussion about the future of the industry and the direction that we're going. So that's going to be fun. That's what we have coming up on Wednesday. Then on Friday, this you've got to be excited for.
Mm-hmm.
It's the Rumble. It's the battle for the ages.
Finally.
Yes. Ding,
finally.
Ding, ding. Jeremy Silva, mm-hmm. Dr. Paul Acosta, Soil versus Hydro.
The never-ending battle.
The one to end all battles. That's coming 1 week from today on Friday. And then a week after that is going to be the show that we were supposed to have last week, Dr. Lisa Ganora, talking about... I'm going to try to get Jim Frere on that, too, because it's a very Jim Frere show. We're talking about plant chemistry, phytochemistry. She apparently approaches it in a completely different way than the insider weed people do. She literally wrote the book on plant chemistry, so it's going to be a good one. And then the Friday after that, Adam's holding it down with two.
That'll be a hilarious show.
Doing epilepsy. No, he's going to have, like, doctors and stuff calling.
Oh,
is
he serious?
I think it's going to be absolutely not a hilarious show. I think it's going to be with doctors and sick children and talking about CBD and epilepsy.
All right. We'll make sure I make it fun to begin with, and then we'll delve into the depths.
And then the week after that, which
can't
is
believe we're
be,
so far ahead of plan.
Can you see the planning? This is KTI getting it together. We're talking September 23rd now, almost as we're coming out of Mercury retrograde. We're going to be sitting down with... Mr. Soul. I didn't forget it. We have Mr. Soul coming in, and he wants to come and essentially talk completely the opposite of what we talked about the other week when we said feminized is great. He wants to talk about how polyhybrid and feminized seed is shit, and he's as we can trust, he will be strongly opinionated and have some really smart things to say as well. So it'll be a good little show coming up. Maybe we'll get a little battle opponent for Soul. On the other,
sure.
Maybe Colin Gordon.
Oh, we have to have Colin.
Colin Gordon is the guy to battle Mr. Soul.
Yeah, and he wanted to come anyway back because he said he's been getting such
good
feedback from the show. So I was like, okay, cool. Let's get him back on this one.
Well, Colin Gordon, if you're listening now, buddy, you're going to come debate Mr. Soul, I believe. So sharpen your sword. your battle's in about a month, Gladiator. So the Adam Dunn Show Gladiator Arena is brought to you by Way to Grow.
Oh, right out of the gate.
You see that segue, dude?
Wow.
Smooth. Sick.
It seems right out the gate, but it's 3:40.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's a good idea.
Also, I've realized the Segway thing is like if you pull a sick skateboarding trick off and then you stop the skateboard and get off and say, did you see that?
Yeah.
Did you see that?
Yeah, yeah.
That's
exactly
what you do when you land a trick, right?
I know. Well, I'm totally aware of that.
Right?
And I love that I continue to do that to this day.
You're like, wait, stop. That was a sick trick, bud. That's you. That's you going.
That's me. I'm that guy.
Yeah. Big shout out to Way to Grow.
7 locations all over Colorado. They got my favorite, Platte River, 1051. I was down there the other day picking up some gear, and they have, what is there, a sale right now going on?
I'm pulling it up. We're
going
to see.
Up.
It's
up.
Heavy. It's hard to pull up, right?
Wow, it's heavy.
Boom, on sale. Got bulbs?
Got bulbs.
$89.99 blue 6 hundos, $129.99 blue thowies. HPS 6 hundos for $69.99, HPS thowies for $59.99. This is... that time of year.
Yep.
That's
in the spring.
Oh, that's coming soon. That's only September 7th
that's
to September 21st. So get ready. If you're thinking of buying a bulb right now, just roll with the shitty one. You can spare the lumens because Thalys, HPS Thalys for $60. This is the time of year when you go do it. This is when you go buy all of them, and then you buy the second round and the third round right then till next year at this time when he does it again.
That's the way to do it.
That's basically the way to do it.
And you can always check them out at waytogrow.net, right?
Of course. You can.
You can.
You can go to their stores.
Or you just go walk right in. It's great to have a real store.
Maybe don't use the Adam Dunn Show code anymore.
Why not?
Apparently, I have fun saying it.
Try
I guess.
It.
Try it.
Pushing hard. Push that. Push it.
Wishful thinking's good.
I feel like if less people used it, they would let us have it more.
That makes no
They're
sense.
They're like, dude, so many people are using this fucking thing. We can't afford to keep doing this. We're going to go out of business.
But then that's the whole point of creating more business, isn't it?
Okay. Maybe we need a new code.
New code every week.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Or just
But then nobody ever the problem is that people down there don't know what the codes are.
That's
like,
true.
Like, what are you talking about?
All right.
Like,
well,
blue
19. Blue 19. What's the one? What's High Times codes for the pineapple? The pineapple, the code that High Times says on the PA when the cops show up.
Pineapple, right?
Something the pineapple.
I think it's just word pineapple. I think
is it the word pineapple?
I think you just have to say pineapple.
Were we not supposed to say that on the air?
Well,
that. Oh, I guess it's not the but. Fun fact, we're going to do a giveaway at some point, and I guarantee you,
if you hear the words pineapple at a cannabis cup,
the cops are there.
Put your shit away.
Yeah, put your shit away if you hear the word pineapple at a cannabis cup.
That's pretty much the standard thing.
Or at least back in the day. Should we bring a guest? Oh, we got to keep doing shout outs. Shit.
Oh, yeah.
Incredibles Edibles.
Best edibles in the world.
Yum.
Great. Right now, they are rocking some new flavors, I think, aren't they?
Yeah, really?
I think they always are.
There's a peach one.
Oh, yeah, the peach.
Yeah, the peaches and orange.
Peach Dream is good.
Peach Dream's good. But yeah, they're the most consistent, the fucking best edibles I know.
Most potent, most consistent, best packaging. They're starting materials. The flowers hash they're starting with. Like every step, the quality is a notch up. You can't compare. If you're coming to Colorado, if you live in Colorado,
D-Money runs a tight ship there.
He sure does.
He makes sure everybody's in line doing their shit proper. So
absolutely.
You don't see much deviation from that.
No, and that's the consistency is really,
that's what you want in an edible. I mean, the most important thing
And that's the hardest thing to find when you have all these like cottage industry edibles in California and stuff like that.
Always been the Achilles heel of all edibles has been like, well, I ate it once, it didn't work. Then I ate another one and it worked too much. Yep. And then, you know, so you...
One side of the brownie pan gets you higher than the other.
Right. And there's been just so much inconsistencies along the way. And I mean, I guess that's one of the things that regulation sort of brings, is consistencies.
Wow, we're exploring so many nuances in this episode.
Nuances.
Being outside is really changing everything
for us.
I don't know.
Should we do the show outside all year long, winter long, summer?
I started taking some new herbs, too. That could be it.
Oh,
I got one you could take. It's what Genghis Khan took.
Oh, nice.
It's called Desert Sistanch.
Sounds cool.
Yeah, it's cool.
Nice.
Dark Horse Genetics.
Dark Horse.
I was going to do a Genghis Khan tie-in with the horse thing, but it's just way more effort than it's worth for like one person. KTI would appreciate it.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, I know. Well, I'll tell you later, buddy. Dark Horse, what are we doing right now? We're putting Rec Seed out all over the fucking state is what we're doing right now. Processing a lot of beautiful hash for people, but putting a lot of the first line of Dark Horse out. And
that's pretty much the first line of
from what
actual
we understand,
seeds that are rec, right?
Or yes. So there are some, I found some, like one store that has some seeds because they were like med seeds that they had in their vault that they did in their conversion. So there's like some rec seed out there that's fucking 5 years old. Like
right.
old
Great.
The first THC packs in Colorado and shit.
Great.
But no, as far as fresh rec seed coming out now, us, dude, we're the only ones. Got some exciting stuff. Keep an eye. Dark Horse International's doing some fun stuff too.
Nice.
Keep an eye on Attitude Seed Bank. You know, the way it is with all the things, right? Like, we don't like feminized breeding here. Maybe Mr. Soul will support that. Maybe Colin Gordon will convince us against that. Who knows? But feminized Bruce Banner lines, feminized Gorilla Glue lines coming out. All the Dark Horse International in the European markets coming damn soon. So keep your eyes out for that one.
Nice.
Of course, big, big shout out to Veg and Bloom, hydroponicresearch.com. We could get Rob on to talk about it, I bet, but he's too busy.
He's too busy.
He's working. Do you see? He's like sitting
there
with a laptop. He's got his things in.
Crazy.
It's like a coffee shop or something.
You think,
most people charge you fucking $5 an hour for that or something.
We could start.
You want to rent? You want to? No.
No.
Because this is the shit. Veg and Bloom. Again, the biggest, best facility, most consistent facility, most impressive facility I've seen in the United States is Phil's facility
in Illinois.
Mm-hmm. And it's on Veg and Bloom. I don't need.
I was down at Pueblo and went to see Kevin, who we dropped off some beans with Jason.
Oh, Kevin. Yeah,
Kevin,
yeah.
Kevin, yeah, exactly. And there he's running. It's funny. We went into the grow. It was almost like the show sponsor.
It was like the show sponsor.
All the sponsors were on the same shelf. I was like, good job, man.
Yeah.
Veg and Bloom, he's rocking it. It looked really good.
Looked great, right?
Yeah, looked really good. And he was his room was super clean, too. Like, just tits clean. It's nice.
Did he have – so everything? The build
had,
soil?
Yeah, well,
was
he doing
build soil and Veg and Bloom?
We didn't have build soil. That he did not have. But he had grow stones, and he had Veg and Bloom, and he had what else did he have? Had somebody else advice.
Seeds here now? No.
No, I couldn't see the seeds here now.
Bart. Obviously Dark Horse.
Obviously Dark Horse. Mm. We were dropping them off, right? So
probably way to grow. Of course, can't forget Build a Soil.
There was Build a Soil stuff. It just wasn't
Build
a Soil.
That's it's not soil, but like aloe vera, coconut.
Yeah, exactly. So.
And of course, great segue, Adam. Build a Soil.
Build a
Jeremy's
soil.
Coming on. He's willing to do the battle in a week.
I know.
He's
is he punching a bag right now?
He's punching like, a dirt bag. He's got a big bag of dirt, and he's just punching it. And then Paula, what's she doing?
She's weightlifting some
rock wool, giant rock wools on a
grow stones. She's pumping. Yeah, pumping.
They're getting ready. It's going to be a great battle.
It's going to be the battle royale,
and it's going to like so cool because it's like pure science battle.
Oh yeah, it's going
to
be great.
Having facts defend opinion is hysterical. We're excited to bring Jeremy on for that. Of course. Big shout out to Grow Stones, not just for providing the bags for Paula to lift, but for providing Paula herself and a hell of a product.
And a great alternative to perlite, which, you know, just like this whole unsustainability of this industry is the fact that we need to kind of come up with ways that, you know, every time you pour in whatever product you're using, you want to know that that's able to be replenished. It's
right.
Not like
it somehow it should contribute to. They should package. All right. So he should put out nutrients, and the amount of nutrients you go through for a bag of growstones should be packaged in glass bottles, enough glass bottles to make a bag of growstones.
Wow. There you go.
That close the loops.
Closed loop system again.
See
once
that?
Again.
That's how we do it.
But yeah, I feel if you're, you know, just like corals, perlite, all these products, at a certain point, there's no more.
There's
left.
A finite amount of these in the earth.
And we're mining them. So if you can figure out a way, like they do with recycling bottles, 100% recycled glass, awesome product. And?
Of course, seeds here now.
Going up there next month.
Seedsherenow.com.
Yep, check them out. Got all the big players on his list, that's for sure.
Yep. He's got some Dark Horse coming too, I heard.
And going to be going up to Alaska. He's sponsoring me to go up there and check out the I've never been to Alaska. It's going to be awesome. And
let's give by the way, can I have a huge thank you to Seeds Here Now for getting Mephisto Genetics on here the other day?
That was awesome.
That was like a sleeper show. You know, it's like one of those people that like I honestly didn't know him. Didn't know their reputation, didn't know their work, didn't know anything. So glad we had them on the show. What a great discussion. Great genetics.
Yep. And grew a good kid.
And that's James Bean. He's out there kind of like scouting for talent always. And that's
he is a talent scout.
He's got ethos on there. He's got, you know, everyone is on our fucking show. That's
right.
For sure.
Right. So
even people who aren't on our show.
What?
People who are better than us.
What?
Yep.
Crockett.
I was just looking at Crockett. That's specifically who I was looking at when I said that.
I thought you might be.
Yep.
But yeah, thanks James for that. He's always looking out.
And looking forward to seeing Adam's report from. Hey James, you want to get Bog one time, buddy? I noticed that you have Bog. Bog is one that a lot of the forum folks want to talk to. I know you're out there listening, Mr. Bean. It would be cool to get Bog on one of these days. You heard the dates earlier, so it's gonna not have to be till like October, but
right,
would be cool. All right. You
want
to bring in a guest?
Let's
do
it.
Kayvon. Yes, let's do it.
Come on, man. He's on a short schedule, too. So
is he?
Yeah.
He's a busy man.
He's a busy guy.
Super busy guy. I didn't shake his hand because I was doing the show when he walked in. What's going on, buddy? How you doing?
Yep. Busy guys. I had to get him down here. He almost tried to cancel on us. I was like,
no,
that ain't happening. That ain't happening, buddy.
I like the new space.
Yeah?
Thanks.
It's good. So we're getting together. See downstairs. That's where this is going to be eventually.
Yeah.
We're getting it around. Yeah.
Wonderful.
Oh, Kayvon sounds great on the mic.
Do I?
Everybody else sounds better than us. I don't know what it is.
You guys sound pretty sexy.
Do you do a podcast? You did a podcast.
Yeah,
I'm on podcasts. I don't have one yet.
You did? No, okay. Get your own. We're going to have a studio.
Come on.
Whoa.
Yeah,
Kayvon. What? That's a great show.
That's how I lure them in. I bring them on a show.
Our show.
By the way, you have your own show now.
We do have a podcast studio at Sexpot Comedy's offices now. That we allow local comedians to use for free, which is really nice.
We're not funny enough, so we got.
We definitely are not funny enough.
You guys are funnier than some I know.
I know, right? Comedians, we'll talk about why the bar is so low on comedians nowadays, but we'll deal with that later.
Blaming Netflix or what?
I have theories. First of all, I think the internet killed jokes. Like the classic joke was killed by the internet,
yeah.
And then I think internet humor is quickly producing Tosh.0 and other substandard comedians. I don't think Daniel Tosh is funny, dude. I'll stand here and say it. It's trite internet humor. And he probably has a podcast, so he can talk shit about me all day. But
the thing about him is he's got a group of writers. That's what makes it not funny. Because you're like, this is not coming off the top of his head. There's no, it's not a one-man show.
Anyway, you're not here to talk about comedy, are you?
We can if you
we
want.
We can.
That's the best part about people like Kayvon is it can go in any direction. We'd be like, what do you want to talk about?
Well, can we talk about social use? Because that's what we wrote
in
the title of the
episode. Yeah, let's talk about social use.
All right, what's happening? Are we going to legalize smoking pot in clubs or what?
Yeah, you know, there's a couple initiatives that are going to potentially be on the ballot. I think there's a probably a pretty good chance that Normals is not going to make it. They didn't submit really enough signatures, I think, to get over that validity rate, but we're going to find out here in the next week and a half. So
was it just because of bad, just crappy signatures?
Yeah, what's the difference between the different initiatives, too?
Yeah, so you need, first of all, to get on the ballot, you need 4,726 valid Denver resident signatures from registered voters. The validity rate, especially when you're dealing with volunteers, is like 50%. Normal turned in a little over 6,000.
Do they get paid per signature?
Some people do.
Yeah,
that's when you get a problem.
Predominantly volunteers. We paid for ours. When you pay for signatures, you usually get 60 to 70% validity rate.
They're a little
better. People that try a little more. We turned in 13,000 signatures.
You crushed it. Even if half of them were
I feel really good about getting on the ballot. I'll put it that way.
Yeah.
That is the better initiative.
Yeah, so what's the difference between your initiative and the other ones out there?
The Normal initiative is for cannabis clubs only. It restricts.
Like a licensed cannabis club type thing?
Yeah, but that's all that could really happen there. You know, there's no food production. There's no overcross with liquor licenses. It, in my opinion, segregates the cannabis user from non-cannabis users. The point of social consumption, in my opinion, is really goes back to the intent of Amendment 64, which was to equalize cannabis with alcohol. We allow folks to purchase and possess now, but not socialize in these same environments that we all love and go to, clubs, bars, restaurants, coffee shops, yoga studios, all of these things. Those would be allowed under our initiative, the Neighborhood Supported Cannabis Consumption Pilot Program. It allows any business the opportunity to participate in allowing cannabis consumption.
So what is it? You have to be business, commercial real estate, basically? How is it designated, the parameters?
You could theoretically be a individual person as well that chooses to rent out a art gallery for an event or a venue for an event or something of that nature. And unlike Normals, which limits the special events to 24 a year, so to a month.
That's weird.
You could have one every single day here if you wanted.
Sure.
The
way better.
Every day's a holiday around here.
It overlaps with liquor licenses as well, which is bothering the state, and they're starting to talk about that a little bit because the one thing that concerns the state or the city in this is it's really a made-up fear, which is poly drug use. That's the term they use.
Is that like another drug?
Using cannabis and alcohol together.
What does that do? Is that how the Incredible Hulk
was made?
It makes
your head blow up, I think.
Yeah. It's like Pop Rocks and soda. You just don't mix them.
Blow up.
It's funny, they're worried about this thing that, you know, are people not going to use cannabis and alcohol together until this passes? Been happening, right?
Are they not going to? Do they know about college?
Yes.
Have they ever heard?
There's stats that we have now that we can push back on this a little bit. We can say that since legalization passed, Amendment 64 passed in Colorado, DUIs are down.
Yeah. I mean, they like to, like, somehow, for some reason, they like to pretend like they're up, but you're like, no, they're down.
Down. That's
pretty
a
sure
lower number, yeah.
That they will fight back. What's that?
Underage use.
Yeah, underage use since Amendment 64, you're seeing actually stay steady. So that there's this huge fear that you're going to have teens just dramatically exploding in their use. You've seen people.
Well, again, same thing. We always could get cannabis. Now it's like you can't get it if you're not old enough.
You got to jump through some hoops now.
Take this to the smart people. They're not smart, right? Smart Colorado.
Yeah, yeah.
They're against social consumption, but why? You know, just because they're against cannabis. If they really think about what we're doing here, we're taking people that are now consuming in parks and on the streets and all these places in front of kids.
In a car.
And putting them inside Sohi Gallery in a designated 21 and up space where they can consume responsibly.
Right.
So if they were really smart about this and really cared about the kids, they would support this initiative as well.
It's always about harm reduction, you know, and that's the idea of the whole thing from day
very
one.
Very Dutch, Adam. Very Dutch.
It's what
Dutch is. Harm reduction is my favorite topic.
Yeah. Yeah. And that's the whole idea. And then the idea is to give them a safe place to consume and also to not, I mean, the problem is when you say you have to have a separation of everything, it starts to turn into a youth center at that point. You're not even like, it's like, what are we doing here? I'm 47 years old. You're trying to keep me from having a beer and a joint? I mean, that doesn't make any fucking sense. Like, there's never been a study which has said one compounds the other. There's no negative, you know. Yeah, it's very hard. And the thing that's weird is that people are so easy with alcohol. Like, there's never, you know, kids are around, no problem, whatever.
Restaurant, whatever, get shit-faced right there.
Everywhere public. It could be anywhere.
Well, I mean, part of it's that it's in the air,
yeah,
right?
That's the
reason. Is there any clean air pushback you get?
So we are in accordance with the Colorado Clean Indoor Air Act.
Okay.
That can mean a lot of things. You know, normal says that they're flying in the face of it, that they're just disregarding it, whatever, they're going to go to town on it.
They say that openly? I feel like that's not the best way to...
They say that behind doors. They will say if you ask them about it, they'll say in Colorado Clean Indoor Air Act, if you have a business that has 3 employees or less, that you can smoke indoors. Now, what they don't say is that in their license structure...
We have less than 3, so...
Yeah, we have no employees.
But there's the gray area of whether this is a private thing where you can... I mean, technically, you could do a ticket.
It's a private event. There's going to be someone at the door. Not anyone can come in.
Exactly. Theoretically, you can do that now. But there is gray area. There are people still getting very much in trouble for this. It's affecting other parts of society.
Right.
But what normal doesn't say is that with their licensing structure, maybe we're only going to see 10 to 15 of these licenses pop up. There's tens of thousands of people that need to use these places. Are you telling me that you can have 1,000 people in one of these places and have 3 employees the entirety of the week and expect that that's going to somehow solve this? Yeah. I would prefer to take those 10,000 people that are using.
Spread them out
over 1,000 licensed consumption areas around the city, and you have 10 at each. Yeah. It doesn't become this concentration issue that it's not an issue. The city's worried about it. They use it as their talking points in Globeville, Elyria, Swansea to get these cannabis businesses in trouble. So that's the reason we have our neighborhood supported component of this.
Mm.
When this spring, city council was supposed to talk about social use. They didn't. They instead decided to make it more difficult for cannabis businesses that are operating right now to have an existence. They put these caps on, they restricted, they put the moratorium on, they required this good neighborhood plan, the odor control plan, all these things. What they didn't tell you was that they're actually doing it so they can expand I-70 and the fucking Cowboy Palace, Great Western Stock Show. Nonetheless, they're throwing the industry under the bus. Is it the industry's fault? No. But what can we do now is be proactive with that conversation and say, we're going to require a dialogue with these eligible neighborhood organizations. There's 187 in Denver that we can get support from. We already have 5 or 6 on board right now. This is going to happen. We're going to get the support of neighborhood, even do better than these liquor license establishments, operate in the city, prove the sky didn't fall. And this is going to become a competitive thing, I think, amongst businesses, amongst neighborhoods, to actually try to attract these cannabis consumption businesses. And that'll normalize it just like that, in my opinion. I think it's going to happen quickly.
Yeah, and I mean, it's better to go with a established business that's already, you know, knows its people, it knows what's going on. It's not a huge change. All it is going to add, you know, and I always say this every time I know a restaurant where they let you smoke, I'm like, I don't know if I should tell people or not, because if I tell too many people, this place will maybe doesn't exist anymore. You know what I mean? Because it's like, but there is places that are smart and have been doing that already.
That's a worry of mine with the normal model is, how do you create a business model around you? We're creating something new that doesn't currently exist. Instead of what we're doing is taking existing business models and expanding it to include the social consumption of cannabis. You have other things, because you can't sell cannabis at any of these clubs, regardless of what initiative we're talking about.
Sure.
If you can't sell food, if you can't have these other ways of generating revenue, you're going to create a door fee. One, that's going to turn people away.
Yeah.
And two, I don't know if you could support the function of a real business with door fees.
No, it never does work. I mean, that's been always the problem with the people trying to do social clubs and not having a real business plan besides that. And, you know,
then they end up selling weed under the table and get busted for it.
That's
because
true.
They don't have any other way to make money.
That's
pretty much the cycle. Yeah.
Yep.
No, and we just read that article that you can now get a blowjob with your coffee in Geneva. Yes. So now you can have a joint with your coffee.
Sounds wonderful.
You know, the idea of adding a service onto an existing service easily.
For the record, I was just chatting with a lady over there about this. As soon as kind of the drug policy conversation has cooled down a little bit, that's going to take a while. No doubt I'm still in this for the long haul beyond cannabis. I am going to work on legalizing prostitution, decriminalizing for the woman or the man that's actually providing those services. The John necessarily not so much on the front end,
mm-hmm.
The pimp not so much on the front end,
sure,
but the person that's being exploited through human trafficking, through these power dynamics,
sure,
to treat that as a public health issue as well. So I just wanted to throw that in the air.
Some more Dutchness.
Very Dutch.
He's like
very Dutch.
We're throwing in all sorts of Dutchiness.
Yeah. Kayvon's here making Denver awesome. That's basic. Turn Denver into Amsterdam.
I can't wait for this Art And event, September 16th. I hope you guys can come. It's at McNichols for the grand reopening.
Okay.
I got the city to pay for a drug policy event in partnership with the Drug Policy Alliance. It's about arts relationship with civics, entrepreneurship, technology, livelihood, social policy, drug policy.
We love all that stuff.
To soften all these conversations.
Sure.
So.
Right.
And it does overlap. This is the conversation we were having over there about how this is the first we've seen, like, technological sea change in our society in the past, in our lifetimes, but this is the first real cultural sea change that we're seeing where it's like a radical reevaluation of against dogma in a 10-year period or whatever, and it has really broad-reaching implications for policy, for basic society stuff. All kinds of questions are being brought up, and they're not the sorts of questions we've seen in our lifetime. So I think it does. It extends outwards, and there's going to be a lot of, like, logical next steps.
Yeah, I think there's this feeds
logical.
Into a
no,
lot of...
That can't happen. That's impossible.
This not only feeds into a lot of things, it puts a lot of people that are cannabis consumers that I think we will probably all admit are perhaps a little more creative on occasion than some other folks, just to allow new ideas to enter the fray and for them to be considered, to have more of an open mind. I think we're going to quickly see that snowball, not just in Denver, but across America. I think the fact that cannabis legalization has sped up to the point that it has, the fact that we're seeing California, Nevada, Arizona, Massachusetts, one-third of the country vote on some level of cannabis legalization this year, is a testament to how quickly this is snowballing, and it's just the start.
Yeah, and it is pretty amazing to watch because, like, we obviously can't have our finger on the pulse in every single state and what's going on, but when something pops up, it's like, really? I didn't even realize they were that
they
far.
They were doing that.
They were
yeah.
on that. You know, it's like, and it's pretty much getting to that point where it's almost a juggernaut, you know what I mean? That keeps going, and it's not going to get stopped.
Yeah, I can't imagine it. Whoever becomes president next, that there, even if they wanted to turn this back, that there would be a chance. I mean,
right.
One, you have public opinion, right? We have over 80% that believe in medical across the country, over 56% that believe in recreational. We're all starting to have lobbying dollars. People are mm-hmm. in this industry going to protect their interests without a doubt if they feel threatened. So I'm really excited for the future of cannabis. I just hope that we can do things that keep it in the hands of people that have really been negatively impacted by the drug war over these last 10 years. That's something I'm doing with the Minority Cannabis Business Association, is creating template legislation, rules, and regulations for states to be considerate of having more licenses, having fewer lower license costs, retroactively looking at drug charges and offenses on people's records and expunging them so they can get a fucking job, so they can keep a roof over their house, maintain custody of their children for doing something that is illegal today but was illegal a year ago.
So here's a little puzzle I've always wondered about, right? Like, if we legalized it tomorrow, magic wand, Obama's on his way out, legalize it, free all the drug prisoners, right? Where are we going to house and employ all these people? Like, in certain communities, like, the majority of the population, or a sizable chunk, fucking 40%, is in jail for drug charges. You let all those people out at once, all of a sudden there's just a lot of unemployed people, potentially without housing, and you have a whole different set of social challenges. Now, would it be awesome if we could employ them all in the cannabis industry? Yeah, but is there that much work for them here?
Reappropriation of funds. So think about what it costs. We were just talking about this over there, $80,000 per inmate per year.
Per year, yeah.
To house someone. If you have an assisted living facility that has treatment, rehabilitation, and counseling involved in it.
Sure,
that
job
actually
training,
treats
all that.
That actually encourages people to get better instead of continuing to hold their foot down or to hold their head down at their foot. You know, you're probably spending $30,000 to $40,000 a year supporting that person. So it's almost a reappropriation until that reintegration happens. But this ties into so many other things. I mean, think about getting back to a local economy, right? That's something I hope that cannabis can continue to provide, is that local economy source. I don't want California, just because it's already the largest agricultural export in the state, when they legalize cannabis, for that to create a huge detriment to the state. It's going to
sure.
detract some tourism, but we can still maintain our cannabis agricultural economy here, and I hope that we can. But it's about local economy, period. When you go back to food, when you go back to construction materials and hemp, and we start talking about that and all the things that we could control here locally that we don't currently, that creates those jobs for those people that are getting out of those prisons, I have no doubt.
Sure. Okay, you're good at solving difficult questions. I got another one for you. So we got all these bars that are set up to be conducive atmospheres to getting wasted drunk, and we're going to have people smoking herb there. How do you make them better for that?
So part of our initiative is within it, we essentially encourage third-party training like TIPS to exist for cannabis. So to understand cannabis consumption and then that polydrug use, understanding that people are using multiple drugs, these are the signs of it, these are how you should treat it, yada, yada. It's education. You know, this has been prohibited for 80 years. It's going to take some time to have everybody on the same page with what's appropriate and what's not. Now, is that going to work? Obviously, we should know a lot about alcohol at this point. We don't.
Sure.
Because people are still allowing it to negatively impact them dramatically and over-serving. But alcohol also takes away that ability to have a judgment, you know, to make good decisions. And I've never been too high to make a good decision. I've never been to a point where I did something I wouldn't normally do.
It's usually the opposite. Usually you second guess yourself.
Get all paranoid.
Yeah,
and then
you start, I don't know, this is a good idea. Because you're thinking about it too much, you know what I mean?
Yeah, one of the things with this is having...
You don't usually wake up from being super high and, I got a tattoo. Like, you know what I mean? Like, you know, that's usually drunk. Those are drunk nights when you come home with a tattoo.
Yeah, I haven't had the tattoo I didn't want to get, but I've definitely done other things. all inappropriate. But they're designated consumption areas that are inside these places. So theoretically, could it be an entire spot? Sure. But it could be just a portion of this that is separated, physically segregated from the rest of that place. Maybe they have a door person there that's managing the use back and forth. Maybe they want let's stigmatize us and throw on green wristbands on people that are smoking.
Can we get away from the green? Is that okay to do like...
Pink wristbands, I'm sorry.
Sure, it's like the green 420 pot leaves. Can we switch it up?
You know I'm the biggest opponent of the 420 rally that possibly exists in Denver.
Let's talk about that.
You want to?
Sure.
That's actually, it was the impetus for our green team, which was us going out there and providing a positive impact as opposed to the negative perception impact, the detriment that the 420 rally, in my opinion, creates in the public perception. Is there a way to do that respectfully, responsibly? Without a doubt. Unfortunately, that doesn't happen because usually you have the lowest common denominator.
It's a free event.
Yeah. It's one of those things where you have one person ruin it for 10.
Sure.
And that's compounded by the fact that there's 50 to 100,000 people down there. But we went down there with the green team and started picking up trash collectively as a group. And that expanded into all these other initiatives that we're doing. But I agree, we should get away from these old-time stereotypes and negative perceptions related to cannabis industry. They're doing us a disservice.
Feels like Uncle Tommy. Like it feels like, it feels like this weird like kowtowing to the stereotype, and like, I don't know. I don't think it serves us.
Yeah, I agree.
You know, so hopefully not green wristbands. To get back to where we're at.
I'm gonna go with gold.
Sure, gold.
Pink. Pink soft color.
Great. It looks cool under a black light, which scan your wrist with.
There you go.
So this could be any business. Bars, clubs, we're assuming restaurants potentially.
Yep. Yeah, no business is precluded except
bank?
For
like,
cannabis
could you have
businesses.
A bank with a that is the fucker. But that's where places like this are also.
And that's a state law. And that's a state law thing. So even if we wanted to change that in Denver, we could.
Are there any other laws that would, like, is a place preparing food or something, would there be any law that would prevent you from having it there, or are there other laws that
This overlaps with every license type. It allows the opportunity for every single business type to engage.
Even
in
an office? Like if this were just like, this is a smoking weed office.
As long as you had that support from your neighborhood organization, which, again, there are plenty supportive. I sit on the art district on Santa Fe Board of Directors. That's one of these organizations that could approve it. We're certainly talking about it. The Bluebird Bid, Business Improvement District, East Colfax, West Colfax, Capitol Hill United Neighbors, Uptown. They're all talking about allowing this. Out of 187, I only need one. Because I know that one is going to prove that the sky is not going to fall on this and that it's a good thing for users, for businesses, for districts. This is a way for Art District on Santa Fe that is nothing like Rhino, that doesn't have the resources of Rhino or of 16th Street Mall or downtown or Cherry Creek or whatever, to create a differentiator, to create something different about what they are, to get people down there. And I think they're totally willing to take that on.
Sure. And frankly, it's a draw that competes on a bigger scale. Like, where can you go First Friday in the country where you can smoke weed all along at the galleries? Like, it doesn't exist, and there's a draw to that.
There was one gallery. I used to remember those stuff.
Yeah, in Santa Fe. There's a cool spot on Santa Fe for a while.
There was.
Space Gallery does quite a bit down there. There's still places that are willing to almost do this publicly and say, we're fucking doing it because there needs to be a solution here. Well, and even the city, we've talked with Mayor's Office and City Council about this. They agree that there needs to be a solution. They're supposed to come out with a notice today about how they feel about this initiative in Normals. I didn't see it. I didn't see the statement, but it's coming soon. They agree that something needs to happen, though.
Yeah, no, it's a crazy like situation here when you look at it from that. It's like it's a classic. It's almost like when I was in Amsterdam. People came to Amsterdam and be like, "So where are they getting all this weed from?" And I'd be like, "Ah, it comes from, you know, the sky, basically." And then here it's the exact opposite. It's like, "So I'm here and there's where do I go to smoke?" You know, and I'm like, "There is no place." And they're like, "Huh, this is so weird." Like, and it just seems so obvious.
They never give you the both sides of the
can't have both. Yeah. You know, it's like that would be crazy. That's crazy talk. So, yeah, no, it seems like a marriage of the two would be the perfect.
Yeah, have let people purchase cannabis and use what they purchase.
Wow, what a crazy concept. You know what I mean?
The beauty of our, and talking about Amsterdam, there's not a place in the world that regulates the social use of cannabis. There's places that allow it. There's not places that regulate
it.
Denver would be the first.
And so what would the regulation aspect of it be?
So it's set up in the initiative, and it's very plain. 21 and over, out of view of the public right of way, out of view of places where children congregate, in accordance with the Colorado Clean Indoor Air Act. Outside of that, it's pretty open. It does leave it to the eligible neighborhood organizations to create additional rules that fit in with their neighborhood. So if, let's say, the Santa Fe Art District said, well, we only want these social consumption places to exist Monday through Friday or during these hours or whatever, they could do that and come to an agreement with that prospective permit holder before they submitted it to the city. And I think that's important.
Now, can they veto it altogether? Do they have, you know, total authority?
So these neighborhood organizations, you need a letter of support.
You do. Okay.
But I think that that's going to be an easily achievable thing. And it may not be widespread on the front end, but it will happen.
And now, what are these organizations composed of? Like, is it business people? Is it citizens?
So there's registered neighborhood organizations that are predominantly residential neighbors in those neighborhoods that are elected. There's business improvement districts that are created, like on Colfax, for these communities, both residents and business owners, to get together and find resolve in some of the issues that they're dealing with in these issues in these neighborhoods. And there's merchants associations that are collections of businesses there for the furtherance of that district economically.
And a lot of them they're voluntary organizations, right?
Totally.
Like anyone can be on them.
Exactly. So, okay. And people can create registered and eligible neighborhood organizations.
Oh, cool. That's
so let's say that all this, for some reason, we get this massive amount of pushback. Well, let's come together as an industry and let's start a neighborhood organization in a place that's going to be friendly to it and continue taking this over ourselves.
Sure. Yeah, that's promising. It sounds like, and there's obviously popular support for it. So what's the rest of the process from here?
So we submitted our 13,000 plus signatures about 2.5 weeks ago. We have, I think it's 13 more days in the process. They have 25 days essentially from when we submitted to certify us for the ballot. Assuming we get certified for the ballot, that has to be done 60 days before the November 8th election.
Right.
Then we're just in education mode. So we're going to be holding an LGBT fundraiser, Democratic Party fundraiser, Republican Party fundraiser, cannabis industry fundraiser. We're going to engage every single group. We're going to send an email and offer up a meeting with all 187 eligible neighborhood organizations. We're going to be meeting with every member of city council. We're going to be meeting with the mayor's office again. We're going to engage every single person, pro or con, to this issue, on this issue, prior to that election. We just got polling set up today. We should have those numbers back middle of next week. I expect to have about a 62% approval rating. We had 58% last year, and it started dwindling because we didn't have the education and ended up pulling it. This year we got the education. One thing I want to do, because last year they said the Chamber of Commerce doesn't want this. Denver businesses don't want this. Well, the Chamber of Commerce doesn't fucking represent the majority of businesses in the city. So I want to get 300 to 500 businesses on board in formal support.
We have
of this
3 to 5 businesses. We could be 1%.
I want
we
all
could
of
be your
them.
1%.
I want all of them. No, I already have about 40 to 50 right now, and many of them are not cannabis businesses.
Right.
They're coffee shops, they're music venues, they're restaurants. That's going to be important for the perception of this, that everybody wants this. This isn't a cannabis industry thing. This is a Denver thing.
And it's very much like a Denver culture thing, right? Because it happens to be that those are the places where when you're doing something cultural is when you're sitting there and you can actually smoke herb. You're out listening to music, watching something, art gallery, enjoying food, coffee, whatever. Or what's really cool is at work. Like, you start the first, like, yep, this is a co-working space and you could smoke here. Like,
a co-working space is a wonderful example. Because that would allow for a space. If you have 100 people working, there may be 20 that want to smoke cannabis when they want there, just like you can have a beer at your desk at these co-op spaces. Right, to allow for that opportunity is huge. That's part of the video campaign that we're going to be releasing here in about a month. That is providing some color to all these businesses that people may not associate with this legalization of social consumption.
Sure.
Massage parlors and yoga studios and the art
100%.
Galleries. And,
yeah.
You know, this isn't about bars and restaurants. Those are going to be the far minority of the businesses, I think, that take advantage of this. It's going to be the broader dynamic of the cannabis culture and environment.
Yeah, and it opens up so much for people to then, I mean, now you can't, like I was saying, you can't tell people, oh, yeah, go to this spot. If too many people go there, blow it up. Now it can't work anymore.
But
the minute that you're allowed to promote it, then those companies, we're going to see such a great expansion of their customer base. It's going to be huge. And the other ones that are across the street would be all, why are they so popular over there? They're so busy.
I mean, I think of
no
every...
No one comes in and gets coffee at our coffee shop. They go over there.
Yep.
I don't think their coffee's very good.
Evolution of market. I love it.
And, yeah. You know, I think that's pretty obvious. And people, I think in 5 years, are going to look back at this and be like, why was it such a struggle to even get to this point? Like, ooh, you know, and it's just because of that changing of the guards, you know, right now. We're in that whole... The old crew can't believe it's happening, and it's like you were saying, the future of cannabis is really good, but the people who don't like cannabis, it's going to be really bad for them. Shitty future, you know what I mean?
Good thing they're in the far minority, right?
Yeah, and hopefully they're coming around. And
well, you know, the difference is that one of their kids or one of their family members will have cancer, and all of a sudden somebody will recommend them a CBD or some THC product, and then all of a sudden they're like, oh, well, this stuff actually is good. And it's just like it's inevitable that everybody gets touched by it at some point, because everybody's been touched by cancer at some point in their friends, family members, whatever. And so not everybody's gone in that route, but now we live
as it's more effective,
It's more effective, and as it's packaged better, and it looks more. It's
more
not
normalized.
Some hokey, you know. It's not some guy
non-flower products.
And then they're like, okay, I will try it, and you know, and as we know, most of these products actually do work. So that's where they'll be like, huh.
That's the approach we're taking with talking with all stakeholders. Is back to, you know, what you just brought up. Amendment 64 in legalization in Colorado was so powerful and successful because it just engaged the dialogue and the conversation. And once people realized that Susie Q Homemaker and the doctor and the accountant and the lawyer and the whoever consumed cannabis too, took away all the fear of it.
Right.
And when people actually see this happen out in public or social spaces, not public, in social spaces, it's going to take away that fear as well. They're going to actually see people engage in it, and it's not going to make a difference. There's not going to be no fear factor associated with it, but you need to expose that use, that dialogue, if we're going to change that.
And now, is it, you know, do you know if parallel conversations are happening outside of Denver?
So California and Nevada both have social consumption aspects to their ballot initiatives this fall. And that's another thing that I think Denver, if we want to maintain our status as being at the forefront of this movement, as being the example of continuing to really be the push here, we have to do this. Because California and Nevada are going to pass. Those things are going to happen. If we don't do this, we're looking as secondary in this movement.
What do you think the impact and potential impact of, you know, net drop in tourism from that loss? Like, if we lost all the tourism, what's the economic impact of that?
If California and Nevada just legalize and they don't legalize social consumption, I don't think it's that big of an impact.
I think
it's pretty big. I don't think it's going to be dramatic. It's not going to destroy our industry.
I noticed less people coming already, though. Like, just because it's moving around so much and there's so much going on, like, there was a lot more focus on Colorado 2 years, 3 years ago. Now it seems like, yeah, people might show up. There was so much, you know, High Time screwed up so bad, and a few other people.
You're talking industry-wise.
Industry people. Yeah, not tourism. Industry people, which is a good indicator of, like,
sure, yeah,
if they're not showing up, you know, it's not going to make it any more exciting for the other people to be here, in a sense. So it's like, you know, when there's that energy of a place, like, like Amsterdam had for so long. It was like, people came, oh, my God, I'm here, it's so great, you know what I mean? And then, but now it's like, eh. America, we got all America. We don't need to go there anymore. So it's killed there. I mean, it's definitely.
But
impacted.
Now a lot of people are in, or everyone's setting up shop in Oregon right now. Everyone's in Washington. I'm with you.
Yeah. So it's just like the new energy, and it's like a kind of, and because of cannabis being, you know, so sexy and the cool thing, it's like it has to move. You know what I mean? It can't stay in one place.
Right.
It has to
otherwise
keep moving.
It wouldn't be chic.
Yeah. Otherwise, it gets seen it, been there, done that. You know what I mean? So yeah, Colorado needs to step its game up in that way, in that regards, because we've already. pretty much set our...
Oh, dude, ski lodges, casinos, yeah. So many, like, cool touristy
And
base.
Those are the places that in the beginning were allowing it because there was no real rules base, and then all of a sudden they all kind of, we can't do this anymore, and then... I'm sure that did not help their sales out at all. You know what I mean?
Yeah, think about Amendment 64 when it passed. Denver was the only city in the 10 most populous in Colorado to allow it, to allow recreational cannabis sales.
Right, at all, yeah.
And now almost all those 10 are either doing it or thinking about it very strongly. This will be the same thing here. And we may have something that forces their hands because there are two state legislative initiatives that are coming forward. Jonathan Singer had one this year. That got moved towards the end of the session. Didn't get enough time to get discussed. He tabled it. They're going to bring it back next year, and I'm hoping that if this passes, it feeds into that and changes it, makes it fit together, and then hopefully passes, because then that'll force these municipalities to say, if we don't want it, then we have to talk about banning it and have that discussion with our citizens, our residents here.
Mm, so it forces the dialogue, at least.
Exactly. So we're going to be pushing that a big deal, a great deal. I would definitely, if there are politically active folks out there, to start contacting state legislatures, their representatives, because this is going to be a big topic of discussion, especially if Denver passes in the legislative session next year.
And I think, as Adam was saying, I think the economic stakes are massive. I know the difference that I've seen in Colorado in the 10 years living here, sort of pre-2009 to now, economically has been
huge.
Unbelievable. Unbelievable. And at least anecdotally, one in four of them is for cannabis, if not like two in three of them seem to be.
Yeah, there's energy and technology that are doing it, but
yeah,
when you talk about the cultural, like the quality of life perspective,
right.
Colorado trumps a lot of places in this country, and cannabis is a big part of it. And the fact that lends to the thought that we're more progressive, that we're more liberal, that this is just a better place to be.
And since Amendment 64, I've seen an amazing amount of tourist traffic. We had the rec dispensary going. You've had the rec dispensary. You see how it becomes like the one beacon. It's centrally located. That's good, you know. But everybody who wants this experience comes here for it. My concern, specifically Nevada. As we've said, California is like the best place in the world to smoke herb. But Nevada is like the logical thought for Joe Sixpack to try and go find and buy his first pack of joints. Like that happens in Las Vegas.
Yeah.
Colorado's a departure from that. And I think it wins by default because it's where it can happen. But I think as soon as the sort of the most rational alternatives come up, I don't know if we get, people are still going to come here for ski trips and they're still going to go buy herb. No doubt about that. But are people going to come here for their herb trips? Not all of them, that's for sure.
And there is some good to be said about that, right? I mean, if we do want to reduce the strain on affordable housing and reduce the strain
on homelessness. No, I love it. Oh, please, legalize it everywhere and, like, spread
it's the
this.
Same,
yeah, there's still plenty of money.
Back to Amsterdam again. But, yeah, same thing as when I was living there the whole time. I was like, you guys do realize if you just had a coffee shop in Belgium, none of these people would be driving over here. You'd be making all the money. Like, that's how simple this is. They're driving over from your country, spending your money on our stuff, and going back, and you're getting all pissed off about it. Well, go fucking open your own, man. How simple is that? You know what I mean?
Exactly.
Same thing here. It's like if all the states just took the pressure off Colorado, and, you know, the first legal states, Washington, Colorado. Well, the other places aren't really even doing – nobody's doing anything. That's the hard part. It's like no one's got – that connection between the social use and the distribution, you know?
I mean, even before social use, you don't have, like... The thing is, so many people are just wrapping up their application processes. In, like, 5 years, when we see all these states coming online, kind of maturing, going through their first cycles, as it were,
mm-hmm.
I think it's all going to start to level... Like, the market's going to come into play, and you're going to start to see standards. And by then, 5 years from now, it's not going to be 25 states. It's going to be, like, 40 states or something, if not all of them. Like... I don't know, I was talking today about someone who just moved out here from Florida or something a few months ago about the old days, you know, pre 109, pre 1284, you know, just after the Holder memo, because we were discussing the Russians. And they're like, who are the Russians?
Oh, yeah.
And I was like, you guys don't even remember
the good
the
old
Russians.
Days.
Yeah, man. Like, that was Denver, man. So, but. To look back on the good old days, right? We haven't even seen the good old days yet, I think, on a
totally
larger scale. Like, holy shit. Like, we feel like we've seen the golden age of dispensaries here. Wait till they open in Manhattan.
Yeah.
And wait till they open in fucking London. You know, like, what?
No, wait till social consumption happens and all of a sudden sales are allowed just like alcohol is in many different types of establishments.
Sure.
You know? Why can't a bar sell single-serving joints or edible products or things like that? It will get there. So once we legalize that social consumption in the first place and people feel comfortable enough with that, then, yeah, we do move into a 7-Eleven type of establishment where certain potency caps, maybe certain milligram caps, things
but
like that.
But you could smoke. Now, with the, of course, we want you to be able to smoke anything, anywhere, pretty much. Not anything, but any cannabis anywhere. But naturally, only being able to sell up to a cap, but, of course, being able to smoke whatever you bring would be ideal.
Yeah, and
well, if you're saying 7-Eleven, you can't smoke in a 7-Eleven.
No, but the idea of buying.
Purchase. Yeah,
like you can't buy, you can buy 3-2 beer in a 7-Eleven, but you can't, you got to go to the liquor store to buy beer.
Right.
Especially like we're going to midnight. I mean, the fact that we have to close our dispensaries down at 7 o'clock here still drives me fucking nuts. I can't, it blows my mind.
Yeah, and it's like.
To me, it's not a, I understand it from a safety perspective because as you're talking at 11 o'clock at night, there's a lot of cash on site. And that's my, or that's the perception at least, right? Like, I know not every dispensary has a lot of cash on site, but obviously with, and I know this is totally the fucking prohibitionist argument, but, I know it, but on the real, dude, seeing the last week, you know, last few months, all the break-ins and stuff, when those happen, obviously you have people there, you're less likely to have anything happen, that's totally true. I guess,
Coming up
with a mitigation approach, I think we should be open late. I think having a mitigation approach built into it makes it less open to debate.
Here's my approach then. From 7 to 12, you have to have a security guard
Boom.
On site.
That's it. There you go. You got it. You hit it on the head.
Well, but we know what happens there, right? Last time, that guy got shot.
Adam, that's not what you're supposed to say.
it's kind of like saying just because one guy that had schizophrenia was on schizophrenic meds, shot his wife, or some guy that's visiting from Wyoming fell off the balcony, that edibles are going to kill everybody.
Right.
Yeah, that's a bit ridiculous.
But that those are the arguments. It's like when people point to edibles being this huge danger on society, they point to two incidents in several years.
Right. Exactly.
Let's talk about how many people died of alcohol consumption yesterday.
Sure, and shot their wife or whatever. You know, there's all that going on too. And that's just one of those classics where they're like, yeah, we got something on this, you know. And it's like, the edibles are really like one of those ones where
I bet both of those people use other of the same product. Like both of those people use laundry detergent during that same period of time as well.
Totally. Right. So,
all right, we got to do shouts, and we got to shuffle guests.
And we got to switch. Yeah,
do it. The website really quick.
Oh, no, you have to do it.
The Neighborhood Supported Cannabis Consumption Pilot Program, vote November 8th. You can register to vote if you're in Denver and vote on this. Make it happen. Fuck Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton. Those probably aren't reasons to get out to the ballot, but this is socialuse.org. You can find all the information you need to. If you know any businesses that want to support this in Denver, please let us know. We'll get you on the website. We'll create a coalition that is unmatched and ready to take this on.
Awesome. I think once this gets momentum, I want to cover
I'm
it.
I'm glad Kayvon's on the case.
That's no, I'm glad he's the one on the case. Yeah.
Glad he's on the case.
It's happy to do it.
There's a lot of other people it could be who I wouldn't want to be doing it. I don't want to. Can we say we're glad the normal one didn't do it? It's
Fuck
not normal.
Yeah. So glad it didn't work. Yeah, so glad.
Trust you a lot more with the job, buddy.
Thank you. I appreciate that. Normal's not like out of the running yet, but we're getting there.
No, well, it doesn't sound like it's such a great idea anyways.
No. They're not going to get it. I feel like when we have Kayvon on the show, it's like when the Justice League has Batman on and you're like, mutual hero respect. You know, we don't operate the same ways. You know, we get it.
That's, we all live in the same community.
Yeah. We're all fighting the same bad guys. That's what matters.
Yep.
All right, man. Well, thank you as always.
Thank you, guys.
Are you hanging around? You got to go, right? You can't even hang around for the party.
Wow. No. When's the party?
Tonight we're doing an opening. 7 o'clock.
It starts at 7?
Till midnight, yeah.
I'll be able to come back. We got High Plains Comedy Festival that I'm a part of.
Come on through.
Funny
come
guys.
Back through.
Yeah.
It's nice to get away from hearing people just talk on stage, too. So.
Sure.
No, yeah, definitely come through. It's going to be a good show.
Sounds great. This is a beautiful space.
Thank you.
Thanks. Yeah, good job. Take a quick look downstairs, too, before you leave.
Yeah, that's good. That's your future home.
That's where your
future home.
Your new studio.
This is going to be directly impacted by social use.
Oh, yeah.
This is
already
for sure.
Is. Yeah. Thanks, guys.
Yeah, thank you.
Quick shout out then.
Shout outs. Would you summon Diane, sir? Thank you. Oh, she can hear us. Wow, look at that. We need the soundproof green room, like on the radio, because then we could talk all kinds of shit.
And then come on in. We're just going to do a quick shout out.
Shout outs.
And then we'll bring you in.
Big, big shout out to Way to Grow.
Way to Grow. 11 years in Colorado. Actually going to move. moving up to 12, I think. And they are doing their...
Got bulbs.
Got
starting
bulbs.
September 7th through September 21st. It's only a two-week sale. It's not a month sale.
Okay.
So heads up.
Now.
Right. $60, 1,000-watt HPS.
What? We need Adam.
Warming
now.
Up. Is he here? Can we get him to do
Could
it?
Could have Adam do it, though. That would have been a good time.
$69.99 for the HPS 600s. $130 for the blue 1,000-watt. $90, $89.99 for the blue 600-watt. Again, that's September 7th through September 21st. At every Way to Grow, all of them throughout the state. To find out more, find out where they are, check them out at waytogrow.net. Of course, big, big shout out to Incredibles Edibles.
The best edibles.
Are they
going to
be here tonight?
Yeah.
With the Incredibus?
No.
No.
No bus, but they'll be through. I think they'll come through.
Come through.
I think they'll come through.
Cool.
For sure.
Hopefully we see them with the
represent.
Orange cream soda.
Hopefully.
The can we talk about the pens?
Sure.
The pens are great. Incredibles pens, Incredipens.
They are incredible. It's official.
They're so good.
No, they are.
I hope we get some tonight.
Is that what you're waiting for?
I'm saying it on the air.
You're just waiting. Patiently.
Do you notice how excited I am tonight?
I can see it.
Yeah.
It's a good one. It's going to be a good show.
That's, yeah. Also, I got to get you on some of these potions.
Oh, man, these potions. Incredible potions? Are they incredible?
Maybe we'll actually talk to them about doing a potion line.
They should.
THC and Deerhorn.
Whoa. Jeez.
Yes.
Look at you go.
Yeah.
They are everywhere in Colorado and apparently Nevada.
Boom. Oh, well, now you can eat in Incredibles and go fucking watch Blue Man Group.
Yes, you can.
That's awesome.
I would suggest blueberry then at that time. Right? Blueberry flavor and Blue Man Group.
Man
pretty cool. You can always check them out at iloveincredibles.com.
Yeah.
And
that's where
if your shop doesn't have them, do them a favor. Make sure you tell them you get those in your shop, and I guarantee we'll sell out. Get those peaches and cream. Those things are fire. Fireberry, actually.
Fireberry.
Oh, my God.
Fire.
What's your favorite Incredible candy?
I like the coffee chocolate.
Oh, yeah.
Affogato. Blueberry was my initiate into
sure.
The affogato was it.
Okay, I'll keep doing shout-outs while Adam reads that. Come on. You got to read it. It's urgent. Big, big shout out, of course, to Build a Soil. Jeremy coming on next week to bring us the battle between soil and hydro. Of course, Build a Soil, our favorite spot to get all your organic supplies, equipment, etc. Check them out at buildasoil.com. I just talked to Jeremy last week. I love talking to Jeremy. Adam's fleeing now, so he's taking care of the issue. We're going to welcome you in 1 second. We just got to say all these things so we can keep doing the show.
I understand.
You get how sponsorships work? Cool. I didn't want to have to explain it.
It's a necessity.
It is. Necessary. Necessary good. Necessary good. Big, big shout out, of course, to Dark Horse Genetics. Check out what they got on Attitude Seed Bank. A bunch of good crosses out there, a bunch of limited edition stuff. And, of course, like I said, Seeds Here Now is going to have some of the banner lines. Of course, here in Colorado. You got a legit dispensary? We got legit genetics for you.
Finally.
Hit us up. Finally, right?
Finally get genetics.
Real genetics. And the way we figured out to be able to do TH Seeds, Archive, bringing multiple breeders' genetics out, it's going to be an exciting, all that stuff's going to be coming out by December. We're going to be doing, re-releasing some of the Epic genetics stuff, some really exciting work. So you can find out more, of course, at darkhorsegenetics.com. Big, big shout out to
Vegem Bloom.
Growstone.
Oh, Growstone. Shit. Sorry.
It's okay.
Forgot our order.
That's all right.
Forgot.
Where's your bottle?
I don't
what
know.
The
KTI.
Fuck?
Where's KTI?
KTI. KTI.
My baba.
My baba. KTI.
Hey, my baba.
KTI. What is the deal?
No baba? No bottles?
Well, you're doing a group with two Growstones. We don't have a bottle.
Yeah. You got a bigger beer than me. Tonight,
right? Crack it. You got me a booch.
Nice. We have water. We have
cheers.
I have a water over here, but
cheers, Growstones.
Yes, thanks, Kyle. It's in my purse. Actually, that's
look at that.
Oh.
Growstones.
You never did that. You never did that.
Growstones.
What do I have to do? Oh,
cheers.
Cheers. I thought I was gonna open
you don't have to open my kombucha. No, I got it.
Thought you were weak from gout.
No, I'm powerful from fucking all these potions.
Oh yeah, slow down with the potions, kid.
No, dude, I'm gonna keep getting more. I want to have that dude on the show, the guy who makes the potions. Can we do that?
This is for Spring Hill, I guess, right? Yar.
Yar for Spring Hill. Of course, Growstones.
Growstones.
Our favorite use for glass bottles.
basically in this industry we need to figure out how to come up with some sustainability, and that's what that product is a 100% sustainable, because right now I am making a growth stone.
Right now. Right just now. By what our just normal by, life, oh, we make growth stones.
Everyday activities are creating growth stones. Not gout or butter stones.
No. Kidney stones? Nope. Growth stones.
Well, you could be producing all of it.
Same. Right. You could if you're drinking beer. Not kombucha, though.
Not kombucha. Or your potions.
Nope.
Big shout out.
Big shout out to growth stones.
And now Veg and Bloom. Let's
okay. Sure. Yeah, transition.
Big shout out to Veg and Bloom. The most professional food out there if you are a big-time, large-scale grower.
If you're growing with salts.
Right.
Just, first of all, why the fuck are you paying for water buying a bottled nutrient right off the bat? If you're buying it in a bottle, you're getting essentially Veg and Bloom dissolved in water. That's what you're buying, and you're paying for the water. Just buy Veg and Bloom. It's the only thing that makes sense. It's easier to use. It's going to last longer. It's going to mix better.
The consistency is what also key. And it's, when you start talking large-scale grow-ops, it's very hard to be consistent, especially when you have a lot of different people trying to do mixes and mixing up 7 different products. And
sure.
It's like very human error is huge, you know what I mean? And a little bit difference each time can really wreak havoc on your yields and on your consistency. So as far as consistent products out there, I'd say that's the one right now.
The one. If you want to run like clockwork, run with Veg and Bloom. Find out more at hydroponic-research.com. And of course, seeds here now.
Seeds here now.
Seeds here now. Seeds here now.
That's sweet. Whoa, she's getting
it's cool, right?
Bye, guys.
We used to be panned into different ears.
Seeds here now for what? They have like 30 different breeders now, I think.
All the big American breeders, some not American breeders, all the big breeders.
Yeah. Check online, see what you can get from them. They got all sorts of crazy deals going down. They got some.
What they got?
Hold on.
What'd James say?
Plug. Hold on. I got a plug.
Got a plug. Plug it in. Oh, I got a plug too.
It says plug. Oh. It says Moe's a go. Moe's coming to Alaska.
Cool. That's the plug?
Yeah.
That's our plug?
That wasn't really a plug. Let's see. I don't know. I can't find their specials because my phone's not working.
Not working. James, buy Adam a new phone so he can hit your specials. I got a plug.
Tell me.
From our guest the other week, Dr. Elaine Ingham.
Mm-hmm.
She liked us so much, she sent us a plug.
Really?
Yeah.
Tell us.
Dr. Elaine Ingham.
I wasn't, because you were by yourself. That's probably why she liked us so much. There's so much more respect to the guest.
4 classes and 8 books, 25 hundo. It's her back-to-school special. You got 16 days left. That's our guest from last week, Dr. Elaine Ingham. Discount only available until September 1st, so you got a few more days. They got a life in the soil class, a compost class, compost tea class, microscope class.
Ooh, microscope's good.
I took a microscope class.
Did you? That's cool. That's the fun
You think
part.
That's cool? I have the DVDs. I can give it to you.
Yeah, that's the fun part
about. I thought you were being sarcastic. You like? Yeah.
Yeah.
Let's
that's the only part that I thought was cool, because it's like, oh, now I'm doing something. Now I really, I'm getting in there.
Nice. All right. Cool. It's cool. Well, you know what we should do? We should get a microscope for the show
USB.
And have her do, and show it on the show and do a class.
That'd be cool.
That'll be cool.
But then nobody will buy her $2,500 deal.
We'll do it something different.
She might not like that deal. She'd be like,
no,
she'd come and tell all my secrets for free.
There's no way that we can cover in one show what she's going to cover in 4 classes.
Just show us how to identify some things, because that's one thing.
I just like watching them eat each other. They're really slow, and they're like,
that's all we ever wanted on big screen.
Big screen. Projected. Yeah. Oh, that's what we're doing next event here. Next diary movie night.
Just microbiology.
Okay. Guest?
Guest. Miss Diane Fornbacher's here from
Ladybud. Welcome.
Hi, guys. How's it going?
Thanks for coming through.
Thank you.
On the short notice, as we usually do. We're very good at that. Like, you want to be on a show? But,
it's your style.
So welcome to the show. Have you ever actually even listened to our show? Probably not.
I tried to find some old recordings from it.
Did you find them?
A lot of friends who've been on the show, but I've been taking an unpaid sabbatical for several months, so my apologies.
That's fine.
I've always liked you guys, though.
Oh, good.
She runs like an upstanding journal.
I am.
It's the opposite of us. She's the opposite end of cannabis media.
Right.
It's classy.
We do write about cannabis, but for us, it's about overall drug policy reform, as well as we need more art in this world, which I think anyone and everyone can agree with, pretty much.
Yeah, it's like that bumper sticker, that Earth bumper sticker.
Where the art is a different color,
yeah,
so it stands out.
Whoa, I love that one.
I do. I think that's a really fucking
I still love it every time, yeah.
I do, because, I mean, having a gallery for years, it's like, it's part of the getting people to appreciate
it's part
art.
Of heart, too.
Oh, bro. But it's part, but it is definitely, like, you know.
It's part of smart, too, oh. Bro. Let's do a T-shirt.
Yeah.
Like and then art.
Oh, that's it. We just killed it. All right, show's over. We got a good T-shirt to make.
Bike drop.
Bye, guys.
But no, it's interesting. To, I mean, that is like the whole cultural side of cannabis is always. I mean, weed has always been integral when it comes to music, art, all of these things. We all know it, and so it's not an unusual thing to bring them together. You know, and I think. That's what we're doing tonight. I mean, that's what we're trying to do.
It's kind of what the theme of this show has been.
Oh.
Whoa. So how do you contribute to that, Ms. Fornbach?
How do I contribute to art?
Sure.
Well, we like to sort of go out there and really find people whose heart is not only in art, but also in making a difference. We like
using
to unify.
Total brainwashed. If we started a cult, you would join it in like 2 weeks.
I guess you guys will be joining my cult because I already got one.
Oh.
Yeah.
See, that's how that works.
Yeah.
But, you know, that's what I mean, though. I mean, you know, everyone
so
has
culture
feelings.
Art, we agree.
Exactly, yeah. Exactly. It has to be interesting and smart to be a cult, or it will be a boring cult, and everybody will drink Kool-Aid because they just can't wait to get the fuck over with.
Yeah, we don't want that kind of cult.
Nope.
Different. But we're definitely going to start a cult at some point. We're
safer.
Working on it.
Yeah. A safer cult. A safer Colorado.
Colorado. No, that's this is stage one. That's what Adam Dunshow's been since the beginning. It's like the
junior cult, baby cult. Yeah.
We've got to build your core.
The whole vibe here is very conducive to creativity and to feeling like there's a safe space in cannabis among all of the chaos that we find in this, I guess, nascent, not so nascent industry.
Still nascent. Still super nascent.
Yeah, I suppose the chaos bespeaks that.
Right.
Exactly.
And the funny part is new people come in and they have no idea about any of this and they think we want every shop to be like a Apple store and have no soul. You know what I mean? Like you walk in and you're like, oh, this is the new look. It's just
it feels clean. It looks professional.
Yeah,
but
I
it
like
doesn't.
Messy
it looks
sometimes.
Budget. It looks like it always looks like not custom. It's like, oh, you just went to IKEA and bought stuff that was white and light wood. Like you didn't actually get a counter made like the Apple store. Like. It's like how, it's half-assed. It's never fully committed.
A pseudo-reasonable
But the problem is that when it is really professional, then we all kind of get turned off on that, too. So
some people
like
it. Not us, but there are people. There are people who don't listen to our podcast.
Oh, 100%.
Those people.
Those, like most of the majority of the world, actually.
I think we're 60-40 now and we're winning, but some people.
But no, in general, it's always been like that, though. It's like if it's too slick, there's a reason. Like why
so slick?
You had to get this money from somewhere, And I think that it's weird in Colorado too because
Colorado's not slick at all.
It's the opposite.
No,
normally.
It's unsophisticated.
It shouldn't be that. So it's like when you walk into a place and you're like, oh, this is weird. This makes sense if I was in
why is this nicer than the jewelry store?
Sure.
Yeah, they got like rustic wood counters in the jewelry store or whatever. Sure. Yeah, Colorado's weird like that.
People trust like funk a little bit, you know what I mean? Mm. Oh, it's funky, it's cool.
Yeah,
trust that.
Spend
I do
a
it.
Lot
it's
very
time
hipster.
I do it. And they really try to go Colorado.
Well, if you go to Brooklyn, looks like if you all around Brooklyn, it looks like you're in Louisiana or something. You're like, what the
What's
hell?
That
they
mean?
Got like they got metal flashing on everything, and they just try to make it look old. And it's like, this place has been here for 6 months. It looks like it's been here forever, you know what I mean? They work really hard at that image of making it look old and funky, you know what I mean? But I think it's because the...
It has character, then.
Well, what's weird about it is it's totally artificial, but yet right now, at this time, right now the big thing is authenticity. Like, that's the key to getting successful. If you're authentic with what you do...
You can't buy that.
You'll be successful in this right now because that's what everybody wants. Everyone's looking for that authentic
Can I
thing.
Ask you what you mean by successful? What does the definition of successful mean
I
to you?
I should have asked Adam that once upon a time.
So Ladybud successful if you mean we have respect. Ladybud successful if you mean we've made a difference and contributed. But Ladybud's not successful
side.
If you're talking about, you know, I can
side.
Pay myself what I think I'm worth.
No, and I don't think we we are definitely from that side of the fence of understanding that we'd rather give quality, make no money, than to make money and, you know, sell our soul, basically, which is what we're definitely not doing.
Yeah, it's about making a mark in history, not putting some money in your pocket.
I figured, but I wanted to ask.
Oh, 100%. No, yeah. I definitely don't mark success by money, because otherwise I consider myself semi-successful, but I definitely have not done very good in the financial side at all. And it's interesting to see, because it's like you see where people's their drive is at, and if their drive is money and cannabis, it's kind of like the cannabis has a built-in thing about not letting you succeed, you know what I mean?
And it's this weird thing where it doesn't just bump you right off.
No.
It's a tar baby. It bleeds you dry. You're like in there. You're like swinging. Like, oh, another grand here. Another 10 grand there. And then all the money's gone, and then it bumps you off.
Right.
And it's just
because 10 grand, where's that?
Go. You go to the wrong industry events, I guess.
No, I stopped going to those, actually.
That's where
I don't want any more tomato farmers asking me what I do.
Now, is Ladybug, is that like online only now, or is it?
It's online only, although, did you say Ladybud or Bug this time?
He said Bug, I thought.
Yeah, that's a kid's magazine. Ladybud's what their parents should read.
Bud.
But I know
how do you not get it? It's a pun about weed. It's your favorite thing in the world.
I know. Sorry.
So we are online. Most of our writers come from the activist circle, from the movement. I do like to help lady businesses, so we do have that column Lady Business, but we reach into the industry a little bit for that, but usually we go for a hybrid of what I was talking about earlier, activist and entrepreneur. I'm a big fan of seeing the possibilities in normalizing cannabis, but I'm also very interested in seeing if people really care enough about what they do in order to be able to maybe in the future, once they see maybe a financial success, to contribute that back into the industry and movement that helped make that possible these days. So, you know, we are online. I would have liked to have distributed, but, you know, really
it's
trying
hard.
To deal.
Prince
yeah,
anyway.
From the
really
get-go
hard.
As a startup, it was just a nightmare. So thinking even bigger than that was something that's always been in my mind, but we're not quite there yet.
Sure. And print's dying. Like so many print magazines are going online only. Huffington Post gets a lot more readers than the New York Times, so why not?
Yeah, and well,
I mean, it's nice
we're
to
not quite there either.
It is nice to create something. Like when you get to do stuff in print, it's pretty awesome.
It
feels good.
Yeah,
it's like it's nice.
It's
as a
tangible. It's a gift, and you can cut things out.
But it can also be like when you see stacks of them sitting around from these are all the returns that I got.
I was the managing editor of Skunk like 4 years ago, and I still have thousands of magazines in my basement, which we use on Stoner Craft Night because they're really great pictures.
Sure.
But yeah, with regard to print, I mean the ads look great. The ink is very vibrant, but it's also sitting in my basement.
Sure. Yeah, no, and it's, you know, if you're coming at it from an eco point of view, you're not feeling it it's fine when you're distributing them, but when you see them, like, left behind, or no one ever got to read that one, or this one got all wet or something, you know, I mean, it's just like, it's kind of kills you every time, so it is hard. It's like the same with clothing, like, whenever we do it, like, we sell X amount per year, and then we end up with a bunch of clothes. And you got to hang on to those clothes for like 10 years before you pull them out again.
I mean,
or
I'll
else
take
no one,
them. I'll
yeah,
take them.
Well, of course.
You know, if they're free, I can't help you make
free,
money
of
off of them. So I'm just kidding.
No, I think we can give away free hoodlums.
But in general, it's like everything's in cycles now. So you like it's no good a year later.
Right.
But it's really good about 5 years later.
Well,
like, whoa, where'd you get that?
That one's retro.
And it's just kind of funny as it.
Is that an old school
hoodlum? It goes faster and faster now, you know.
It actually happened with a poncho from Hoodlam.
We don't make
those
anymore.
When Cece put a picture up on the page and said, you know, this is Diane in one of our vintage items, the comment section was popping, you know. Do you guys have that? Do you still sell?
Of course.
And she's
well,
like,
they always want
it
when you don't
vintage.
Have it.
We've discontinued that, but thanks.
Yeah.
No, that's always the case. They always want
classic.
What you don't have. Hey, do you have this?
Capitalism's challenging.
Like, people always used to go in my shop and they'd look at all the colors we have and then they come up and go, do you have that in purple? You know, I was like, you've looked at, these are all the colors, please. You know, like, you literally came up with the one color that we didn't have, you know what I mean? But they were like, just more to piss you off, I think.
Yeah, but that's why you got to just hold two back, hold three back, and sell them at the premium. You got to, like, let me see, I can call over to our warehouse and see if they can dig one up for you. And CeCe just has like six of them or whatever, and then you
the
give
old,
them
the
like
old last one, last one, and then you pull. Yeah,
you get the dusty box.
Three times
you got
more.
Yeah. Uh huh. Exactly. Yep.
Just
this well, this
seem
one
the style here though, you know, just seems like doing the right thing.
Sure. I mean, it's. I think anytime you create a product of any sort, whether it be a book, magazine, clothing, or whatever, it's. You see right away if people doing it for like they're doing it because they're doing it from the heart or they're doing it because they love it. It obviously stands out. Doesn't always mean success. Doesn't always mean they're going to make a lot of money, right. But usually doesn't really affect them in a negative way as long as they're happy with what they produce.
They're proud
you know
of their
I mean?
Accomplishment,
and that's sometimes like all you need, I guess. I mean, at the end of the day, you're like, well, as long as I'm happy, I don't give a fuck what anybody else thinks. But
well, and that goes back to the great economic equalizer of cannabis, right? Like all the people bleeding money into the tar baby struggle, like. No one gets rich, but it all trickles down. Everybody somehow pays their rent.
This is a thing now, right? This tar baby thing is a total thing, it sounds like, in your head.
Yeah,
I know. The tar baby struggle. The tar baby struggle.
You know the tar baby, right?
I know it is.
Yeah, but you can see it, right? The rich guy, like, he looks like the Monopoly guy, really fat, like the 1910 Robber Baron cartoon guy. And he's like, hits him with the cane, and he gets stuck, and then he hits him with the money's flying out of his pockets, and then we're all scrambling around, and we each get, like, a little piece of money.
That's cool. Yeah. Tell me when that's happening.
That's it. That's the industry.
Oh,
that's the cannabis industry. That's my metaphor of the cannabis industry.
Yeah, tell me when
there's
that
a
happens,
lot.
Too.
There's a lot of metaphors for this industry, and they're all pretty interesting. You saw that thing from Dread this morning that he reposted? It's pretty funny.
Is
somebody
the snake eating
that was good. That had nothing to do with the cannabis industry, but it really was the cannabis industry.
Or the boat. You see the boat one?
It was a snake eating an elephant, and then he turned into a brontosaurus.
Oh, yeah.
You saw that one, right?
How dinosaurs evolved.
Well.
That's what it said.
And then they changed it. Someone changed the caption
to the cannabis industry. So like a snake comes up and he eats the thing, and now he's a brontosaurus. It's kind of funny. I thought it.
I've run into a lot of snaky elephants in the rooms at the conventions I used to go to.
Yeah, those two things are in the room all the time. There's always an elephant and there's a bunch of snakes.
And the snake will eat the elephant and act like it's been around since the beginning. It's the dinosaur. Yeah.
That it is. Yes.
Let me take you out to lunch and pick your brain because I'm an investor.
Yeah, we've had that.
Dude, how many free lunches have you had?
I
went for a year and a half. I didn't buy myself lunch.
I got a free
I
lunch and they got $1 million idea. Woo!
Yeah, I know. Yeah. Exactly. No, exactly. I've had a lot of free lunches and I've given a lot of good ideas away. Mm-hmm. And I pretty much stopped, though. Lately, everyone asks, oh, can I take you? I'm like, no, I'm good.
I'm full, man. I'm full. I'm so full right now.
I'm pretty
so full of your shit.
Diane, I love you're exactly where I was like a year and a half ago.
I've been here for years.
No, but I'm there, but I'm also like sort of like reveling and I'm like fiddling while it burns now too. But it's also good to go back to that stage. Tell us how bad the industry is.
How bad is it? I don't know because I don't go to industry events anymore. That's how bad it is. And I like to party, you know.
What was the
big
what was the major turnoff? Was just that all the bullshit ideas and people stealing? And
well, it's just a lot of things people say. I mean, you have to remember I was involved with Normal at the national level. That's enough to make anybody go fucking nuts.
People blame you for stuff still? Like,
yeah,
you're a
you know, when
chick.
I first moved here, people were like, don't listen to her. She's with Normal. I'm like, I mean, I'm on the board, but just trust me on this. When I say I'm not with them, I'm with them at a table meeting a couple times a year.
Yeah, you were the sensible one maybe at the table too.
I don't want
to
have a lawsuit
so.
But I'm not going
to
say you're wrong.
I'd hope
if you assume
so.
That
I'd hope to think so.
I think rules don't apply to podcasts, like how we can say curses, so we can I believe we can say whatever we want about whoever
we
want.
Well,
I
do
want to
add before I get
true.
A bunch of fucking emails about it, you know, chapters are the strength of any organization. Leadership is in flux right now. It's
sure.
in transition. You know, Alan resigned and you know, we have interim people. But for me, how much does the industry suck? That is more movement side that's segueing into industry. Mm. Industry can be beautiful. And I didn't expect anything else. You know, we're legalizing in a capitalist market. You know, I knew, but I didn't anticipate I'd feel the way I did. Mm. You know, for me, cannabis has always been medicine, a civil liberties key, the keystone, if you will, to ending the entire drug war, which is going to take quite a long time. But, you know, as far as the industry, I did try to segue into it. First foray was at Skunk Magazine. And, you know, I started going to a lot of Champs trade shows. And
they're coming to Colorado.
I don't. You know, I like the free stuff. I don't really like the K2 Spice booths.
Yeah. They have the most free stuff.
They do have a lot of free stuff. I actually see people that I've met earlier at these shows who actually own head shops, and they go around acting like they don't own the head shops. they get all of the stuff and then they sell all of the samples.
No, you got to take them all in the hotel.
Yeah.
Did you ever go by the Red Dawn booth? Holy shit.
They're just throwing shit at you.
Yeah, but they what they have is like all these fake drugs, like every drug you can imagine.
Yeah,
but they
opiate
have a fake
replacements,
legal version.
You know,
those are crap.
All that stuff.
No, no, they're. They, they,
no,
what
no.
What do you say, Mitch?
There's good batches.
There's good batches.
I didn't take any of those, but a lot of them get left on the table, you know, that are quickly snatched up. But, you know, as far as the industry goes, I want to proliferate. I want people to have access. I do think there's a component missing of humanity, progress, and contribution backwards into the movement itself. But, you know, I've had someone who shall remain nameless who owns a dispensary and quite a sizable grow say, you know, I really don't owe the movement anything. You know, it's time to get mine. And I'm not going to, you know, criminalize somebody for feeling like it's their time to do that and to make a business and to make a life. But I am also going to say that it would be nice if they did. And didn't
no, there's this
way.
Whole, like, we're at the top. Let's throw that ladder down because this roof can only hold so
you
many.
You see them lobbying actively against what I consider their brethren and the sistren, whatever you say.
Yeah.
You know, and I think that's not cool at all.
In terms of
they want
businesses.
To monopolize.
Well, and it's this weird balance, too, because you have the people who, like, We were the trailblazers. We came out first. We took the risks. We want to make sure we don't get run out of business by someone with $1 billion who just wants to buy us all out. Mm-hmm. And then on the other hand, you want to be like, well, what about all the people caught in the lurch there, right? Like, those people are getting left
but
out.
But soldiers?
And they're all falling through the cracks.
Yeah, I'm never going to leave the trenches.
Well, it's also, like, people quickly... It's amazing how quickly people forget, like, what they were...
Well, it's like you were talking about in the beginning of the show, too.
Yeah, like, they just, like, you know, they're... And for somebody to think that they really were the first is always a kind of a joke because you're like, you realize there's a lot more people before
you. Did you invent weed? Wow.
You know,
wow.
Yet another one. But, you know, and that's the ego-driven side of the industry, which, you know, I was talking with Jasmine about yesterday. We had a nice discussion, and a lot of it was like, you know, I tried to explain to her that this whole industry is, you know, it's unfortunately very male-driven and very ego-driven. And the combination of the two, it's like guys think that they... Our God, all
there's
sudden,
a God,
you know,
cannabis God complex. I was talking about that at lunch with Rob. Yeah,
yeah, and it's just, and it's obviously way more in guys than any I've never met.
You
want to
hear my theory on cannabis God complex?
Yeah, you know, and it's like you guys do understand that you're just a shepherd. You're just like a shepherd of the plant. You know, we're
not doing anything. You're
anything.
Not growing. The plant's growing.
You're lucky the plant can't punch you in the face and punch you down.
Exactly.
Because it would.
Many, many growers
luckily,
would have
luckily, he's a benevolent goddess.
A black eye all time. You know what I mean? Many, many.
So I have my theory on the cannabis God complex. And it goes back to, like, early primal, like the first guys who looked up at the stars and figured out you could time seasons with the stars and, like, fit calculated agriculture and then established a priesthood and made stratified society and, like, established that for themselves. Every grower who fucking figures out how to, like, cut a clone experiences that on a primal level and just gets carried away with it. And sure. I have mastered agriculture. I am the bringer of law to the wild nature.
Right.
All bow down.
Yeah. Well, especially because indoor growing is so reliant on you. You know what I mean? Like, you are actually in charge of everything. So there is, you know, it is undeniable that if you leave, you know, the pump
the plants
off,
will die, yeah.
Or leave the pump off and walk away and they all die. It's like, yeah, you're just as well responsible for their life as their death. And usually the death is more easier to come to than the life part. You know what I mean? So, but the fact that we actually do it once in a while, we do a good job and we, like, pat ourselves on the back way too much, you know?
As I always like to say, I know this old Italian guy who grows killer tomatoes in New Jersey, but he doesn't feel the need to post on Facebook about it every 5 fucking minutes.
I am the king of tomatoes.
Well, actually,
do
actually,
you see this?
I want
look at
all
this.
The tomato
look
cups.
I have a free. I have a.
We know a guy, a pumpkin guy, who is like that though. A giant pumpkin guy
you
who's
have to
all
babysit
about
those
like,
giant pumpkins. You really have to just live next to them.
Yeah. He's out there. That's probably right now. We should check in with Ron. I bet he's like living in the
he's
field right now, fucking going
right
nuts.
He's fingers crossed he's got a new world record again.
You talked to him?
No, I talked to...
You talked to Cameron?
Yeah. Cameron says, you know, they're killing it. They can't talk about it because it's like bad luck, of course. Can't ever say. But he's like, fingers crossed, we're there. We're there. So, yeah, they take it serious. We had him on the show, and it was amazing because it was
like, Jesus Christ, you're saying the exact same shit. Guys fighting over seeds and, like, the same egos.
$1,000 pumpkin seeds. We're like, whoa.
Gotta get into pumpkins, man.
Yeah, we're in the wrong seed game, that's for sure. Pumpkinseedsherenow.com.
So, I forgot, I had some. Oh, future guest I talked to today. friend of my mom's, old friend, and our best. He's our guy. He's our, when we want to do the smuggling show, he is the guy. It was interesting because
I got to follow up on this too. You tell me your guy. I got my guy.
We talked for about an hour, and it was interesting because it was all spiritual talk about the weed, and he had the exact same concept as DJ Short. He's like, you can't grow sativa in America. It's impossible. No, you can't do it. Just can't. Nope, can't do it. And I was like, okay, this is interesting. You are getting a lot of the same ideas. But he also really came from that original smugglers time period.
West Coast? South?
Not sure. We'll find out. Not sure.
So I got... told you I had the family.
But he basically said, he did say one thing, which is pretty funny. He said, first of all, he said, Mr. Nice, fucking joke. Forget about it. That guy didn't do
what?
He
said Howard that, Mark's
he
a
said,
joke.
He said he didn't do nothing. He said there was 25 people running the entire world of cannabis at that point in time. Like,
what about the whole Rolling Stones equipment thing? Is that not a true story?
Could be, but it doesn't mean he was doing any quantities compared to these guys. These guys
that doesn't matter.
Tankers,
that's awesome.
Tankers. And
that's then we'll do. Yeah, yeah.
So, anyway, it's could be a good show.
That's a good show.
It's,
so,
it's just such a different thing between the old world guys who were smuggling and the new kids who are Instagramming, because back in the day, they were sitting in rooms with hundreds of thousands of pounds. No one took a photo.
No one knew about it.
Nobody
yeah.
could, like,
you
want to
spend the rest of your days in that clink, you go ahead and take
and
a
so
picture.
So we're
of
in
it.
Such a different world now, and it's like, oh, yeah, all these kids these days, and they're Instagram, and, you know, and it's like, yeah, you're, yeah, you are right. He's like, you know.
Ironically, on a podcast about, you know, like, saying it publicly to the internet on a podcast.
Sure.
That's the magic of our show, though.
Yeah, say whatever the fuck irony.
You want. Yeah. So, we'll do this. We'll do this and we'll wrap. So I told you that my wife's cousin's wife's parents, it's closer than you'd think. They live in Boulder. We have dinner with them all the time.
Okay.
Were apparently the first white folks from Florida to go over to Florida, to go over to Jamaica and join the Ethiopian Zion Coptic Church and be in that ganja trade.
Nice.
So apparently they've been talking on some side stuff, and supposedly we're going to get some elders from the EZCC from, like, the heydays in the 70s and shit to come on the show and talk about the Florida trade.
Nice.
So if your guy's on West Coast,
yep.
We got a fuck of a smuggler show. I love the smugglers. They've always been my favorite, more than growers, more than fucking...
They had balls as big as, like...
Are you guys familiar with the group Life for Pot and Beth Curtis? Her brother went to jail for life, but his lawyer, Randy Darr, works in the Pier 5 law office with Tony Serra, who's currently representing Todd McCormick in his case, his federal case.
The new one that just came out?
Yeah.
Which is ridiculous.
So if you guys want somebody who's advocated and unfortunately lost, not for lack of effort, of course, Randy Darr at Pier 5 would be a great guest, too. Mm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So would Tony Serra, obviously, and Todd loves the talk, so.
We know that.
We know that. Oh, we know that.
We all know that. Nice.
Yeah.
Are we wrapping?
Are we wrapping? It's 5:02. We got an art show.
Yeah. We do have an art show.
I have a car that might get towed.
Oh, me too. Hey. Tickets.
Hey.
Oh,
fuck.
Like,
me for
reminding
shit.
All right.
Sorry, guys.
Send the KTI.
Well, tell us a little bit more about, so as far as people getting in touch with you or.
Well,
what you're
we
doing.
Have a Facebook and a Twitter and all of that, but the best way to get a hold of me directly is to email me, Diane@LadyBud.com.
Yeah, bud. Make sure
bud. We don't want any bugs on our bud. And, you know, we're going to continue limited publishing in late September. We're actually trying more to get advertisers. But as far as I'm concerned, regardless of that happening, we're still going to fight against the drug war and we'll continue publishing. It's just, you know, to be able to tell people that we're going to do 8 to 10 stories a week without that support isn't going to happen.
Sure.
But I do want to guarantee that I'm never going to stop being a progressive person who wants access for people and, you know, compassion and freedom.
And maybe you'll start doing a podcast.
Sounds
maybe.
Like it.
Maybe.
Right? Right?
I know the people. I know the talkings. I also like the words. And
so look for that, too. Right on. Today was like audition day. That was good.
I know. Two new podcasts. Two
new podcasts.
Wrap it?
Wrap it.
Shout-outs?
Yeah.
Shout-outs?
Yeah, start with a guest.
To everyone staying solid for the progress and access of cannabis, rest in peace to Jack, who died, who fought for the kids' rights to be able to consume or medicate, rather, cannabis in schools, specific to my county, but for the whole state of Colorado. And thank you to his mother, who is now grieving her son.
KTI, follow up.
Shout goes out to all the audience. Thanks.
Okay.
want me to go?
I'll go first. I always have
I'll
to go last.
I'll go first.
You can go. I'll go.
Shout out to my beautiful wife, Cece, out in Sweden with little Nick, coming back home in a few days. Can't wait to see you guys. Big shout out to Ace. Getting to do a road trip. Can you imagine this? My mom gets to actually leave the farm for once.
What? She's leaving?
She's gone. She's on the road.
Where is she?
She went down to see Short, down at the big, gigantic
30-acre
greenhouse. Are you fucking kidding me?
Wow.
It was nuts. She was like, God. She's like, I went to the little one today. It was 4 acres.
Did Rob go there yet?
No. Okay. The little greenhouse was 4 acres.
4 acres and the big one's 30.
That's like the tester. And then the big one's 30 acres. Yeah. You're like, oh, my.
Who's greenhouse? What the hell?
So it was a Dutch tomato guys, you know, and they were just huge. And just they were like, hey, you know what? We got the spot. So they hired my friend who's also Dutch. And he's got to fill that entire 30-acre
farm. We might be working on some genetics.
Yeah. So, and shout out to all the guys
through.
Down there that she's seeing, Shore, Jesse, all the crew. So she got to see a bunch. It was funny. She said, I got these pictures from Jesse Lopez and all these people, like, hanging out with my mom. I'm like, what are you doing over there? And then awesome. She got to introduce her friends to Shore's friends, who turns out that they own the land that his brother had. I don't know, something crazy like that. It's a classic. It's a classic when one person comes to town and then links everybody.
It just connects everybody in that town.
And then she leaves, and they all have new friends, and they all have new connections and stuff. And now they have support. So there you go.
There you go.
That's what we're about.
Shout out, of course, to my remarkable wife, Reese. Little kiddo, Farron, who just got a backpack, her first backpack.
Ooh,
I saw pictures
of it.
Yeah, those are cute. First backpack picture. I don't know if it has a chick chick. I didn't get a front picture. I got a back picture. Everybody who's out here getting ready for the show tonight and everybody who's coming out, I think we're going to have a good one, and hopefully the weather will cooperate.
I got more tents coming. So.
Cool. Back it'll be intense out here.
It'll be intense.
Bro.
Big cloud hanging right over.
That's a smoke cloud. If you want to come on down, 2209 Welton Street. We're getting funky in about 2 hours till midnight. Should be a really good one. There's going to be a lot of people here. That's what they say. I wonder if there's a line yet.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah?
It's down the block already.
Oh, yeah. It's going around the block.
I feel kind of bad sitting in a chair when everybody out there is just standing.
And it's raining.
It's okay.
Too.
They're getting rained on. Fuck them.
Yeah.
Wait for your glass, peasants. They like being treated badly. That's why you can't find money, Diane. You're too nice. You have to treat rich people badly.
If you cross me,
I love it when
you
do that.
Yes. No, you got to do it before they cross you. You got to treat them like shit.
That's true, man. Don't mess with them.
They'll pay you double.
Uh-huh. Exactly. Faster than the guy who's nice to them.
Some people pay quite a bit to get treated like shit. I hear. I mean, I've never had to.
I have a feeling you'd be really good at that.
Oh, yeah.
I hear they enjoy it. So cool, man.
Some stilettos. A little couple stilettos.
I'm about freedom, man.
I'm about freedom.
Don't splatter the blood on my house or set it on fire.
Right.
I'm cool. Whatever, man. Whatever.
So we'll see everybody Wednesday.
Wednesday.
We have, I don't know if you heard, but we have the... CEO of Hawthorne Group coming on.
Oh.
Like physically coming on the show. It's going to be pretty exciting.
Yeah, it'll
Are
be
you
a good
nervous?
One.
No, we're going to be excited. We're excited.
Excited. Yeah. Talk to a bigwig.
Like a happy nervous.
Yeah, we like talking to bigwigs.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right on, guys. We will expect to get some questions from you for that show starting this weekend. I'll post up a questionnaire form. And we're psyched to see you guys on Wednesday. Have a great weekend.
Peace.
Peace.